This episode is brought to you by Petimmune. Petimmune is an awesome company from California that makes natural probiotic supplements for cats and dogs. Petimmune is a supplement that you mix into your standard pet food to improve your pet's digestive health, immunity, and vitality. Your pet will have less stinky farts, get sick less often, and if you really love your pet, you should be doing what's best for them to keep them healthy. That's why I use Petimmune for Spartacus and Maximus. For 10% off, go to PetImmuneOnline.com and use the offer code ICE. That's PetImmuneOnline.com, offer code ICE. Please support them since they're supporting us.
Upon initial contact with Ice-T's music, I had envisioned him to be an ill-mannered and psychologically unstable man with an extremely uneducated and barbaric frame of mind. His raps displayed nothing but ridiculous jargon, shocking sexual audacity, and repulsive images of the ghetto. However, after further analysis of his music, I can deduce that he is the epitome of anti-disestablishment terrorism, who embodies the entire spectrum of the urban experience and struggle. But to make things more plain and simple to the layman, I find Ice-T to be the dopest, flyest, OG pimp, hustler, gangster, player, hardcore motherfucker living today. To be honest, I am totally and completely on his dick.
Welcome to the Ice-T Final Level Podcast, featuring your co-host, Mick Benzo, and your host,
Ice-T.
Hey, yo, what's up out there? This is Ice-T and Mick Benzo. What's up, Mick?
Oh, man, it's good, man. This is number 22 podcast. You know, my voice is a little gone because I was hanging out with Africa Bambaataa, man, and God.
Yeah, you guys had the Zulu Nation anniversary this weekend and stuff. So, you know, Mick been out running around at night. I've been on the job. Every night he calls me, he says, Ice, man, we going to this party, that party. I'm like, man, I'm filming, man. But yeah, you was out there.
I was out there, man. I was hosting. I had a good time, man. My voice is gone, but we can't let y'all down right now, man. Hey, you know who came in town?
I know who we got here, but before we even get into it, we got two guests here today. But why won't just explain to people what the Zulu Nation anniversary is?
Well, it's 41 years of the Universal Zulu Nation and 40 years of hip hop, and we've always celebrated the birth of the music and have guests like, you know, rest in peace, James Brown, Sly and the Family Stone, George Clinton, but not this year. We had, you know, like Jungle Brothers and we had a whole bunch of people there. If you look it up,
Me Cube and Public Enemy did it with that last year.
Last year, y'all did it. Yeah, that was big with Naughty by Nature, Ultra Magnetic. I mean, everybody comes by, and it's just a celebration of the birth of hip hop. You know what I mean? As far as we're concerned, we birthed it out of the Bronx, New York, and it's music, and we have a great time. You can see I lost my voice. I wasn't doing no drinking, though.
No, you were hosting it. You, the man on the mic.
I was hoeing it. I mean, hosting it.
Yeah. so that's what it is. It is the Zulu Nation anniversary this weekend. How many years?
41 years and 40 years of hip-hop.
That's what's happening. So peace out to all the Zulus. I'm a Zulu. Peace to Africa Bambaataa and, you know, everybody else in the nation. On the Zulu Nation anniversary weekend. And in the house today, we got a couple of guests. First off, we got our boy Alex, the man behind the podcast, the man who made it able for us to do the podcast. What's up, Alex?
What's up, Ice? Thanks for having me.
Yeah, now this is the guy who came to Mickey with the idea for Ice-T to do a podcast. I told Mickey, get the fuck out of my house with all that bullshit. I'm not doing nothing. I can't be in no recording studios. I work, I'm moving, and then all of a sudden, Mickey said, you could do it in your own house, you know, on Saturday morning, Sunday morning, when you got a little free time. Alex, what made you know that this was something that had to be done? Because you came to Mickey with the idea for me.
Absolutely. I mean, personally, like, I wanted to start a podcast network at that time. Mm-hmm. And you were the first person I was thinking of to reach out to. Obviously, you're a legend. You're hilarious. You're multifaceted. Like, you're someone that anybody can get into. So it just really made sense. And I feel like after we had that first call, everybody just knew we had to do it.
That's right. That was the business. So your company is called?
The Paragon Collective.
Now, since you actually started with me and Mickey, and you know we've had a great relationship, and you're able to usually do the podcast from LA. Today, you just happen to be in New York chilling.
Yeah, I'm going and doing a live recording of another show I produce called NYRD Radio.
Okay.
The host of that is like Alexis Ohanian, who founded Reddit.
Okay.
So that's another fun one.
So basically you're saying you got other artists. You have other artists assigned to your Paragon Collective?
Yeah, I was in New York to do a live show, and then I was like, you know, why not swing by and do this podcast with Ice?
Definitely, definitely. We're lucky to have you here. Now, since Paragon's launched, how many podcasts are you doing right now?
I'm doing 4 at the moment. Yeah.
Who do you have now on Paragon?
I'm working with Jamie Josta, who was on
from
here before.
From
Hatebreed? Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, no, he's been on our podcast. He's been on our
podcast. Yeah, Jamie said he got the idea from our podcast. Yep, okay, yep. And his is crazy. He's a great dude.
He's great.
Man, Jamie, like, learning work ethic from you and Jamie is, like, eye-opening.
Uh-huh.
I don't think people realize how hard both of you guys work. Like, you know.
We call it hustling. We don't like the word work, but we call it hustling. That, you know, and the thing of it is when you're in the streets, I mean, even if you're trying to do it by illegal means, it requires the same amount of energy. You know what I'm saying? It's like, I don't know no hustler that can sleep all the time. You have to keep at it to get that money. One thing about hustlers usually like to spend money.
Yeah.
So therefore, they have to get it. So we, you know, every hustler I know has always got something, some kind of grind going. And, you know, just when you think he's partying, he's in the corner on the phone still talking, trying to make something new happen and stuff. So you got Jamie. You got RuPaul?
I got RuPaul.
I got RuPaul.
RuPaul is also, he's amazing to work with.
Yeah.
She's very awesome.
Good. Well, you can say he or she. Yeah. I call him he because I've never actually once seen him in drag.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Fucking legend.
But he's a hustler.
Oh,
don't get it fucked up.
Yeah.
There's a lot of gay people, but everybody knows RuPaul.
Yeah.
You know? So
she's dope.
You know,
Mickey just loves the idea of calling a dude she.
No, no. Hey, well, you know, I got a gay buddy named Brian that works on my show, and when he thinks you're gay, he'll refer to you as she, even though you might not want to call yourself gay. He'll be like, she need to stop it. You know? So that's just that's the gay lingo. But I respect RuPaul. RuPaul had Coco on his show as a judge on, I think it's called Drag Race or something like that.
Yeah.
And who else?
Oh, you want me to tell you a funny story, actually?
Yeah.
You want to know how I like got started with RuPaul?
Mm-mm.
So like one of my really good friends like sings with Macklemore, and you know, I was out drinking with him and his producer, who's like RuPaul's like main dude. He's like, what do you do? I was like, oh, I produce podcasts. And I showed him ours. He's like, oh, Ru has got to do this. I want to send him your contact information and like get this set up. But it's like LA, everyone's full of fucking shit, you know?
Right everyone's talking it.
Yeah, you know, it's like I learned from Rue too. It's like there's certain code words where people say yes, but they don't mean it.
What's a code word when somebody says yes? We'll talk about it.
What code word when someone says yes but they don't mean yes?
Yeah,
talk to my publicist.
I can dig it.
Okay. Talk to my manager.
Okay. Yeah. That,
all right.
I got that.
Yeah.
I can believe. Talk to my publicist about that.
Yeah, I was talking with Alexis about that the other day. It's pretty funny. But so I was like, yeah, whatever. And I'm from Seattle, so I'm a Seahawks fan. So I was biking up to my friend's house.
We didn't ask you what goddamn football team you like.
Yeah, man, Alex, stick to the topic. Stick to the topic.
And you know, so I'm biking up to my friend's house. And Jets area. Don't come with that monkey shit about, no, I'm a Seahawk fan.
Like, we give a fuck.
Who gives a fuck about the Jets?
Oh, there you go.
What about the Giants?
Yeah, where we go. All right, anyway, come on. We got another guest, Alex. Cut to the chase.
Cut to the chase. I'm biking to my buddy's house to watch the Super Bowl. I get a call from a blocked number on my phone. I'm looking at it for a second, like, oh, I paid my bills. I'll take this shit. So I take it, and it's like RuPaul, and he's like, meet me at this hotel in West Hollywood in 30 minutes.
What a place to meet you.
With some lube.
So y'all started off in a hotel.
With some lube.
I had to go. I went in the corner of this hotel, and he's sitting there with like a purple like mink jacket, a top hat, and this like dazzled out cane. And just the nicest dude. And like literally, he has one public Hollywood persona, and everything else is all business. Mm-hmm. And I learned a lot from that dude too. But
Well, that's cool. Well, we glad to be part of a podcast that includes somebody like Jamie Jasper. Then you got Ice-T, then you got RuPaul. So you're very diversified. You know, it's very eclectic over here.
Yeah, this is cool.
Yeah, it's not about me. It's about y'all.
That's what's up. Yeah. That's what's up. All right, so we got Alex over here. We just call him Alex. His real name is Alex Aldea. He's in the house. And when we get to the phone part of this podcast, you might want to ask him a question or two. Also, we have Leland Robinson here from the first family of hip-hop, Sugar Hill Records. What's up, baby?
What's up, Ice? What's going on? Alex, Mick Benzo, what's happening?
It's good, man. It's good, man. See, we're not talking about Lost in Space, the Robinsons, because that's the TV show I watch. We're talking about Leland Robinson, the son of Sylvia Robinson and Joe Robinson from Sugar Hill Records from New Jersey. Y'all from New Jersey or you from Harlem? Where y'all from?
I'm from New Jersey.
Okay, so Sugar Hill Records, how could that be? Because Harlem got Sugar Hill.
Mother and father's from New York, Manhattan.
Oh, so they took the idea from the Sugar Hill on the, like, you know, in Broadway.
One of my mom's favorite streets in New York was Sugar Hill. It was called Sugar Hill, like the uptown, like the area, like mm-hmm. I think Amsterdam and all that kind of area.
Yeah.
So basically, that's where, you know, she got the idea of Sugar Hill from.
That's fly, man. But
This is the first hip hop record label. You know, back in the day when I was actually, you know, in the army, and you know, Rapper's Delight and all that kind of came out. I remember I saw that label. I'm like, there's actually a label that's doing rap music. And there weren't any. And
no, they really wasn't. I mean, due to the fact we got Leland Robinson in the house, I want to say something about his mom first and foremost. Your mother used to be an artist, right?
Yes, sir.
She worked with Mickey?
Yeah, it was.
It was me? She worked with me?
No, not you, Mickey.
Oh,
no,
okay.
No.
I thought it was me.
You got monkey business going on. She don't work with no monkey business, Mickey.
Hey. So she did records like Pull It Talk.
Love Is Strange was one of her biggest records she did. What, with Mickey what, and Sylvia.
Wasn't that in the casino? The movie,
yeah, it was
Casino.
In Casino, Carlito's Way, a whole bunch of movies that song was
so
in.
So Moms was famous before she even started doing hip hop.
Yeah, she was a famous artist.
My understanding is Sugar Hill Gang were the first group to put a record out that actually hit the airways or call radio.
Yes, there was.
And your moms did. Your moms and dad did that.
Yes.
Yeah, but look, we're gonna get deeper into an interview with Leland. About everything that goes along with that.
Well, we just
want to
let
project.
Our audience know that we have some royalty in the building alongside of Mick Benzo and Ice-T. That's Leland Robinson and my man Alex from Paragon Collective. Now it's time for us to start our show.
And when you're born into the business like Leland, you really, the history is beyond, you know. I mean, there's things I know. People think, look at me, they go, Ice, you know a lot about hip-hop. I'm sure this man right here knows a lot more, you know, because just being there, from the birth of it, being born into it, it's so many stories, it's so much stuff, so we can't wait. But right now, both of you guys are on the Final Level Podcast, so you about to go for a ride. Y'all ready? Because we go fast and furious, and we go through the world. Are you ready?
Let's go.
Church.
You ready? You ready? Oh, Alex just said church.
See, you've been watching. You've been stealing some words around here,
amen.
Man.
Amen. Tabernacle. Okay. And we going to go. So this is Final Level Podcast number 22, and this is news. Before we get into the news, this episode is brought to you by Audible. They're the world's leading provider in audiobooks with over 150,000 titles to choose from. And you get one free just by going to audible.com/icetea. That's right. You get a free audiobook and a free 30-day trial at audible.com. That's audible.com/ICET. Just for listening to this show. Real readers get their audiobooks from Audible. Okay. What's going on in the news right now, Mickey?
Well, the most important thing to me, Mick Benzo, you know, I got my own dictionary and I make up my own shit, but y'all didn't go out and vote, so the Republicans got the majority of the seats now. The Democrats, now we got to hope that anything that we put on the table, they can pass it by, you know?
Y'all got to go out and vote. Did you vote?
I don't vote. I'm sorry.
You don't make it no better.
I'm sorry, man.
At least I told you to go out and vote.
But at least I'm honest, man.
But you just tell them to go out and vote, and it's their fault the Republicans got all the seats. And you, your ass don't
My wife votes, so that's good enough, man. And my kids. Do you vote?
No, last time I voted, I got jury duty.
So you trying to stay? So now you trying to stay?
I voted
off the
for
radar.
Barack Obama. I'm a vote. I feel if God had wanted us to vote, he would have given us candidates. You understand? So I vote when I'm motivated to do it. But yeah, I should have voted.
No, I think basically the reason.
But I'm not the one out here promoting. You're pushing it.
No,
like,
what I'm trying to say is I think that we don't go out until it's a presidential election to really vote. But all the small ones are good because I did vote for Barack Obama. I did vote for that, but I didn't go out on this one. But we allowed the Republicans to take the majority of the seats, though. That's fucked up.
Well, you know, I think Barack has had an uphill battle ever since he's been in there. So I don't need, you know, I don't know. He's got two more years left. I don't really know what he's even going to be able to accomplish. They're going to stonewall every situation all the way out, you know. So I think all he needs to do is give me that get out of jail free card. You know, that card we were talking about.
Oh, the PBA card. Yeah. Yo, Brock, we've been asking about that presidential card. PBA
card.
The PBA one,
you know,
yours.
You know, Leland, the one the cops give you when they stop you, they give you that little card.
Yeah.
I want one from the president.
That's right. That makes a lot of sense to get one of those.
You know, just before we talk about this, call his numbers in D.C. and see if you should be detaining me.
Yeah. That sounds right.
You can do anything on the way out. On the way out of the White House, you can do anything. You can pardon people. You can do it. He can comb his afro out. He can get Illmatic.
That's Barack, baby.
The last year, he should just get Illmatic, like bring Wu-Tang Clan up.
Make a record, Barack.
Yeah. Go to some parties.
Go to some parties and bring Wu-Tang up in there and part. You know, this fuck it. I mean, it's going to be a long time before there's another black president, so he need to throw at least one good party.
One good one.
Let Puffy host it or something. It'll be crazy. But yeah, what else is going on in the news? I heard, well, I'm not going to bring it up, but you was talking about something else earlier.
Yeah, the students were protesting in Mexico in reference to the government out there. And the word on the street is, because I ain't there, they was kidnapped and murdered by the government and burned, but they blamed it on gangbangers supposedly had killed them. But
and
we know.
Did I not tell you that we do not talk about anything dealing with the Mexican cartel, or none of that shit?
Well, look.
So that's that right there. That's the end of that story. Because we don't do that, because I happen to go to Acapulco. I happen to go down to Cancun now and then for a party, and we have fun down there. They treat me real good in Mexico, and I don't need, you know, Chapo's people popping up at my door talking that crazy talking about the podcast.
That's enough of that news.
This is the World Wide Web, nigga. They can hear this shit in Mexico, and they can speak English, nigga. So fuck that, and whatever happened in Mexico stays in Mexico.
Right, like whatever happened in Vegas stays in Vegas. You know?
Yeah, unless the cartel boys come knock at your front door.
That was the word on the street. I didn't say it happened. That was the word on the street.
You know, it's ill, though, right? You know, I still got street connections, right, in L.A., and they were telling me, you know, the way these cats operate, you know. So now, you know, the dope is coming from the cartels, you know what I'm saying? And and what they do, you know, say, for instance, you wanted to get a key of dope. The cartel shows up at your house and brings you 10 and won't take any money.
Say, we see you later.
Yeah, we'll be back. You just said, I don't want to sell drugs no more. I don't want to sell drugs no more. I didn't want that. I just wanted one, and I wanted to pay for it. Take these 10, and we'll see y'all.
We'll see you later, man. Don't worry about nothing, man. We got
man.
It.
Oh, my
God. We're going to take care of you, man. Good price.
Ooh. Fuck that.
Pay up or get paid out.
No, I don't need that type of consignment for
you. That was news, and I'm gonna leave that alone.
Yeah, we're leaving that alone.
What about the other thing?
What are you talking about, Lee? What are you talking about,
Lee? Obama nominates prosecutor Loretta Lynch as attorney general.
It's a black lady, right?
Yep, black lady at that, too.
That's the attorney general?
Yep.
That's the head attorney in the country.
That's big. So Barack is making moves, and like I said, he's throwing parties right now. He's starting to set up his team.
Yep.
Team for what?
So he can throw a party. He's gonna do it at the. I heard.
So she's an attorney general, and also she's a club promoter. She's got connections. She got everybody's numbers.
You're
something.
Gonna check out Barack at Barclays Center soon.
It's going down.
Didn't he have a black attorney general before her?
It don't matter. They still putting you in jail. Once you go to that level, you under. fucking around with the Attorney General. Hey, man, God bless Barack Obama. And that was news. Hey, yo, this is Five Level Podcast 22. You know, we got Alex from Paragon in the house, and we got Leland Robinson from the First Family of Hip Hop in the building, and this is sports.
Well, basically, y'all keep talking about sports. We was off the scene in the cameras or whatever you want to call it, behind the microphones. And when football is over, it's over. When the New York Giants is out, I don't care who wins the Vince Lombardi Trophy. Y'all talking about some San Fran, some San Diego.
Wait, Mickey, hold up. There you go with that Mickey Benzo monkey shit.
Yeah.
New York Giants are a football team.
Oh, shit.
And that means if you only care about the Giants and the Jets, do you stop caring after like the fourth game of the season?
Oh, shit. No, Mickey was referring to the World
Series. I'm going
to the
Yankees, and I went into the Giants area, man.
He's talking about the World Series.
I know.
San Francisco won. The San Francisco Giants won, right? Okay.
Football.
I know what he's trying to say. Let me interpret for Mickey.
Oh, for
Mickey
sure.
is saying once the Yankees stop winning, he don't care anymore about baseball.
Exactly. And then I lost my captain. My captain go ahead and retired out, so I don't care who won the World Series. It doesn't make a difference at this point. It's time to watch basketball.
I give a shout out to San Francisco. You know I'm West Coast too. You dig what I'm saying? So big shout out to San Fran for winning the World Series. That's what's up. Mickey, the motherfucking Giant, New York Giants are our football team.
86 Denver. I'm not going to play that one.
Now, speaking of football though, you know what I'm saying? The Jets and the Giants are struggling.
They looking real bad this year. You know, they can, I guess, start just scrimmaging right now. Don't play no more games, man. You know, don't play no more games. Y'all making all of us look bad. Seriously, y'all making all of us look bad. Jets and Giants, you guys are making us look very, very bad in New York City. Just scrimmage, no more games for y'all. Forfeit all the rest of them.
My homie Revis went to New England. You know, so he's doing okay in
the
But he
used to play for the Jets, though.
Yes, but he went from there. He went to Tampa. Now he's back up here with New England. So he's getting his money. He's out there getting his money. You know, that's the cornerback. You know, they named New Jersey, they named it Revis Island for him when he was playing. He's a bad man. But the Cowboys,
they're back.
Boy,
man.
They were seven and one now.
They're back, man. I mean, Roger Staubach invented the shotgun.
Robert Newhouse.
Roger started the shot. The Cowboys.
And I used to hate Cowboys fans.
I hate Cowboys too.
I hated Cowboys fans. I only liked Cowboys when Deion Sanders played in the Cowboys for a minute. I'm a Deion Sanders fan.
Who was the running back for the Cowboys back then, Mickey?
Emmitt. Was it Emmitt?
No. Not when Roger Staubach was there.
Oh, okay. We're talking
Who was it, Mickey?
Can't remember.
You can't. You old
I
ass
can't remember,
nigga.
Man. I can't remember.
But you remember the shotgun.
I remember that, boy, like the steel gate with Pittsburgh.
Yeah,
the steel gate and the shotgun was famous.
Tony Dorsett.
Tony Dorsett.
Well, the Cowboys are back. They're winning again. The Cowboy fans, I mean, people that are Cowboy fans got tattoos on their body. They're dead serious about it so they can buff out those tattoos. It's cold, though. You know, like even we brought our band back, Body Count. A lot of people are serious fans, so they had that tat. They tatted themselves up. But then the band disappears. They kind of feel bad. But when the band comes back, they like, yeah. So I know the Cowboy fans are feeling that same way. So, you know, I ain't hating on the Cowboys.
Somebody's got to win. I ain't mad at them. But I'm not a fan of them neither. I'm not mad at them. I'm not a fan of them. You know?
Who are you a fan of?
I done said New York Giants. I asked you guys to just scrimmage. Do not play any more games. Forfeit all of the rest. Stop looking bad, all right?
Oh, shit.
They've been looking bad for
Mickey,
years.
I think we made a mistake. I think the Cowboys are 6-3.
Oh, really?
Oh, they're not doing that good, but they are winning.
Okay.
Yeah.
What are the Jets?
The Jets look like 1-8.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Like one win, one big win.
One and eight, and eight small losses.
Oh, 6-3 is much better than 1-8. God damn.
Did you ever see those Rex Ryan like foot fetish videos?
I think I went to the only game they won. I think I went to the game, the first game with the Jets and the Raiders, and they beat the Raiders. And that was it. And
maybe they need you as a lucky piece. Then you might be their rabbit's foot, man.
And the Giants are 3-6.
Yeah, same. It's just backwards from Dallas.
Traffic is too tough to go to the game if they gonna lose.
We talked about that. We asked y'all can't get us excited if y'all losing, so don't get mad.
Yeah, we talked about
we're pitching a bitch about how you losing.
We want to win. Everybody got the jersey. I got Jets cups here. Revis gave me all kinds of jerseys and stuff. Man, we got Plexico posters.
Plexico when he was with the Jets, you know what I mean? This is not nice. It's not nice. It's not nice.
And we don't even want to mention the Raiders, you know, my other team. You know, rest in peace.
The Raiders are 0-8. I went
That's why I just said rest in peace. And that was sports.
In the criminal justice system, sexually based offenses are considered especially heinous. In New York City, the dedicated detectives who investigate these vicious felonies are members of an elite squad known as the Special Victims Unit. These are their stories.
Hey, yo, we're on Final Level Podcast number 22, and this is behind the scenes of SVU. So SVU is back. This is season 16. Everything's going. I told you there are going to be new people on the show, and things are happening on this show that you're not familiar with. A lot of the shows, well, during the season, there will be 4 to 5 episodes I won't be in. There'll be 4 to 5 episodes that Kelly won't be in.
How could they do that, though?
They're just moving us around. They're just giving people time off. They're just giving us, you know, it's a lighter schedule. It's all good. But they're just jockeying us around. We brought another detective in, Peter Scannavino, who's playing Carisi. He was another detective, so they add another detective, and they kind of just juggle us around. So sometimes, you know, when you do 23 episodes straight through, you can take a week off. When they say, hey, Ice, this episode you ain't gonna be in it, you say, I'll be in Barbados.
The viewers may not like that.
The viewers may not like it, but we're right back to the next episode, and they're just moving us around. It's called an ensemble cast.
Okay.
So they brought in Peter to play Carisi, who's another detective. They brought in another guy named Peter Gallagher, who plays Dodds. He's the new chief. He's coming in and out. Also, Mariska's husband, Peter Herman, is coming in. He plays this guy named Lagan. He's a defense attorney, and he comes in.
Is that Marissa's real husband?
Yeah, and actually, that's how they met. He came in back in the day playing this character on the show, and she met him on the show. So, hey, coming in working on a TV show could get you a wife. You know? A rich wife at that, you know.
Hey, any openings?
Hey, this is what I'm saying. But
Leland Robinson wants to play.
Hey,
so how did that Peter Gallagher thing come on? Because he used to be the dude from the OC. He was like the dad from the OC and everything, right?
You know what it is? They're actors, and you know when you work in the business, Wolf Films is always looking for different people, and you know all of a sudden you'll get the call, and they're like, "Would you like to come on Law and Order?" Usually, you'll come on for. They'll say, "Come on for 3 or 4 shows," you know, and then they'll check how the fans receive you. When I came on Law and Order, I came for 4 episodes. It's been 16 years. They don't just say we're gonna sign you forever. They bring you on and they wait. They give you
a trial run.
They give you a trial run, and the fans will respond to you, or you know they won't. And even like Peter Gallagher, he comes on. He's being an asshole and he's being a hardcore, but the fans hate him.
But they love him the same
but
way.
But that's a response.
Right. Yeah.
So that means he's doing his job because he's coming on there to play an asshole.
Exactly.
So if people like don't care about you one way or another and you're not getting any response, then that means you ain't doing your job. So the show is off to the races. Our ratings are up. We're doing really, really good. And, you know, it's crazy because near the end of the 15th season, everybody's like, are you guys going to come back for the 16th season? You know, NBC kind of made us wait to the last minute and we got picked up. Now we're back. We're doing good again. So season 17 looks very possible.
Don't y'all got other shows? Don't Dick Wolf have other shows on NBC?
Dick Wolf has us, they have Chicago Fire.
Okay.
And they have Chicago PD. And also, speaking of that, Mick, we just did a crossover episode where we crossed SVU with Chicago PD, with Chicago Fire. Like, we crossed all of them. They came to New York and talked to us. We sent some of our people to Chicago because there was some type of a...
So these episodes are coming up?
Very soon. Oh, and it crisscrosses all the shows, which they say puts all the shows in the same universe. Like, in this world where none of this really exists.
Yeah.
Well, in this world, all of us all connect. And that's part of the genius of Wolf Films. He connects all his shows together. So maybe if one of the show's ratings aren't as good, we can kind of lead them in and help, or vice versa. So look for a big crossover between Chicago Fire, Chicago PD, and SVU coming up very, very soon. And the other day, people were asking me, like, when the show came on, they said, well, Ice, why aren't you in this episode? I'm like, well, this year they are juggling us around, so we won't be in every episode, but we're still on the show. As long as that opening credit comes on and you see my ass standing there in that lineup, I'm on the show.
That's right.
Don't panic. Don't panic. You know, and I'm pretty much a staple in that show. I've been there for almost, I came in the last episode of the first season. You know, my fans are solid. You know, they got a thing called a Q rating where they can tell how popular you are. So, you know, I'm in the house. So what are you going to say, Alex?
How does that Q rating work? Like, how does that break down? Because I've never heard of it before.
I mean, you know, believe me, I don't know, but I know the television executives, they basically can watch a sitcom and tell if the joke worked.
Yeah.
They have so many ways of just checking the show, the temperature of the show. Like, you know, I'm going to tell you some tricks they do with television since we are behind the scenes at SVU. Have you ever noticed how a show will go longer over, like, the hour and then, like, it'll go 5 minutes over the hour and the next show will start, so your TiVo will be off or your DVR will be off? What they're doing is they're dragging the ratings from the previous show on to the next show. They're cheating. So that
next hour.
That next hour gets the ratings from the old show.
Right.
Oh, shit.
Unbelievable.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, slick.
It's slick. So they're doing little twists like that to get shows different ratings that don't deserve it. But then they do another one. If it's an hour show, they can tell at a half hour if people dropped off and they left. Hmm. What you want with TV is the show to build, maybe have a you know, it's like 7 million people watching at the beginning and 8 million people watching it in halftime. Like, we want it to grow. The only issue with television is to watch a show, you have to not watch another show. So it has a lot to do with what they're up against. With a podcast, you can watch it whenever you want.
Yeah.
With TV, for you to watch us, you can't watch, I think, what's on against the Mace Cold Case. Not Cold Case, it's
Whatever
the other show is, you now can't watch that one. And then people say, well, I'm DVRing this one, but it doesn't get the same rating as the live action watching. And it's all Nielsen and it's all that. And it's business, man.
So how do they factor the digital stuff? Because I actually like watch you on Hulu because I use the code from the show.
I understand that. It's just very difficult because with Hulu, the commercials aren't being sold.
They aren't?
It's not the same way as it is on network television.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, television is all based around those ads. And the TV show that comes on at 10 that has the most viewers sells their ads for the most money.
Yeah.
Because if, say, we're going to sell, you know, Leland's new liquor, we're going to talk about later, he's not going to say what show it wants to be on. He's going to say, what's number one at 10 o'clock on Tuesday night?
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Just what's number one.
You want the biggest rating spot.
And that's where your commercial is going
to go. That's radio, too.
Mm-hmm. That goes with everything.
So you don't connect your sales directly to a particular show or a topic. You connect it to who's going to have the most viewers. Then you got to do your demos. You got to say, well, if I am trying to sell to women, maybe it'll be SVU.
Yeah.
If I'm trying to sell to men, maybe it needs to be on a Spike channel. It's all, you know, but all television is a way to sell the commercials. And that's why back in the day they didn't like DVRs, because DVRs allow you to fast forward through the commercial.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like counter what television is there for. Mm-hmm. So anyway,
for advertisement.
Behind the scenes of SVU, we got three new people. We got Carisi, who's another cop. People like him. He's ill. I have a good time with him. That's Peter. We got another Peter, Peter Gallagher, who's coming in as the new chief of all of, you know, he's like the top chief of all the cops in the city. He's running around scaring Mariska to death. And also, Mariska's husband, Peter Herman, is coming in and doing some guest spots as an attorney. And just look forward to more and more shows. We got some really good episodes coming up. And like I always say, the only way that show stays on the air is with you guys watching it, tuning in on Wednesday night. And God bless you. You done kept Ice-T employed for 16 years.
Amen. Watch those programs that cross and over with each other. That sounds hot.
That's going to be dope. Hot. It's really going
to
be dope.
That really sounds hot to see. Are you on any of those?
Yeah, I'm on the one with the Chicago PD. People came to talk to us in New York. I didn't go to Chicago this time. Mariska, Danny, and Kelly went out there. But that was cool because it was cold out there. I didn't want to go.
Are the ratings still, is this as high as your ratings are for those other shows?
I think
is he like piggybacking?
Chicago Fire has very high ratings. I think they actually might even have a higher rating than SVU.
Really? Wow.
And then it's us, and then Chicago PD. But we're all in the same general range, you know. Right. And you know, you got to remember, man. Dick Wolf started off as a writer with Miami Vice back in the day. Wow. And he's had so many shows on, whether it was New York Undercover and all these shows, and he's still strong in the business. And, you know, God bless him.
You know what's funny that you say that? Leland Robinson, mom's Sylvia Robinson, had Melly Mel's record in Miami Vice.
Yeah.
Remember that? Oh, you produced it. See that? There's something else I didn't know that. See that?
I produced it.
Yeah. Vice. That was on Miami Vice.
This is what I'm saying.
Yeah, I produced it.
It's a small world. Right. It's a small world, and everything comes around full circle. And that was behind the scenes of SVU. But before we talk about TV, let's pause for a moment to discuss Petimmune. That was a joke. Get it? Pause. All of us at Final Level give Petimmune to our pets. Even Alex at Paragon uses Petimmune for his cats, Augustus and Serio. Okay? So he told me that his cat, Augustus, used to throw up once a week, and after 2 weeks on Petimmune, he no longer has that issue. The stuff really works. Coco has been tweeting about it and using it with Spartacus and Maximus because it's keeping our pets healthy, and it's something that we really care about. It's difficult to do this with just an average diet of dog food. That's why we supplement our pets' dog food with Petimmune. Petimmune is a natural probiotic supplement for cats and dogs that helps prevent your pet from getting digestive disorders, itching, scratching, and excessive shedding. Petimmune also promotes and helps your pet's digestive health, immunity, just overall health, and healthy weaning. It just makes the skin and the coat just look so much healthier. Essentially, Petimmune makes sure your beloved pets have enough of the important nutrients necessary to keep them healthy. With Petimmune, being sick as a dog really ain't sick at all. Petimmune is hooking up all the Final Level podcast people up. So go to PetimmuneOnline.com and use the offer code ICE for 10% off. That's PetimmuneOnline.com, offer code ICE. Please support them since they're supporting us. You're on podcast number 22. You know what I'm saying? We got Alex, the man from Paragon, is in the building. We got Leland Robinson, and I'm Ice-T, and the one and only Human Benzo, Dictionary. The Benzo Human Dictionary
is going nowhere. Listen, Webster got a dictionary. McBenzo has his dictionary. All right?
And this is TV.
Now, the best shows I've been watching, Y'all guys are sitting around the table acting like y'all don't watch Three is Company. And
no!
I love Three is Company, and I love to watch Lost in Space with the Robinsons. I said that earlier today. You know, they had that little robot. You remember that robot?
Yeah.
I watched those. I watched
this that. This nigga watches watch TV that, Land. Did you,
yeah, exactly.
Does your channel, does your, is it that
maybe I ain't got cable.
You ain't paid your cable bill.
Maybe I ain't got cable.
And that's why you watch TV Land all the time.
Cartoon Network.
This nigga is on that shit. I watched Lost in Space. I couldn't deal with Jack Tripper.
Come and knock on our door. We've been waiting for you. Hey, that was dope. That was dope, man. I don't care, man. If Alice can work with RuPaul, I can watch Three is Company.
Three is Company. Somebody.
That is totally not a fair analogy, Alex.
Yeah, that's fair.
What the fuck is the matter with Mickey? What is the fuck? This is a thug. I tell people, this dude is an ill thug. Like, you see Mickey on the street, you be scared. You hand him, he didn't even ask you for your money. You give him your money.
As soon as right? you see him.
And then he's talking about Three is Company. He was like, give my money back.
He
man.
Came dressed up today like a flashback from a 1984 Run DMC concert.
He had a syndicate jacket.
I did not tell you that this is the month of the Universal Zulu Nation anniversary, so we have to be retro, man. We got to go back and show you.
What we got to be?
Retro. Retro.
Retro.
Retro.
Retro. And once again, the human dictionary. Retro.
You wasn't lying about that.
That's my dictionary. That's in the letter R. Find it.
Retro.
Retro. Retro.
Oh, my God. Well, anyway, Coco been watching this show called Masters of Sex. Now, I don't know why she need to watch a show called Masters of Sex, because she's already a master of sex. But it's a show, and it goes back to the date when these doctors were actually trying to really document sexuality. It's like back in the, I think it's in the 60s, because it's dealing with a lot of the social issues that were going on with Martin Luther King and things of that nature, and blacks and whites. But it's a cold show, and it's you know, this one doctor, and he claims that he's doing these this research about sexuality, but he's got a secretary, and he done talked her into fucking her, like, for science. So he's
smart. That's a smart boss.
That's a big.
So he's
big
fucking
boss.
Her, and she's falling in love, and then his wife, he's denying her. So she got jungle fever. She done brought a brother up in the house, and she's fucking him. And it's everybody's fucking everybody, and they talking about they're getting an understanding about sex, but everybody's just boning everybody.
We should put Alex on that show. That'd be a good one there.
Who would Alex play? Alex would be like dysfunctional. I got a problem. You know what I'm saying? I mean, back in my single days, that was one of my games I used to run on girls.
What was it?
I have a problem having erections. I would always issue them a challenge. You did. You know, you tell a girl like I just don't get hard. I mean, when I do get hard, it won't get soft, but it's just not easy. You did get, and you know, a chick would be like, "That's a challenge right there, motherfucker. I can get you hard." Don't steal my shit. This is the same shit me and my boy Rich. Rich used to tell girls. I had a pimp buddy named Rich. Rich right. would be like in the middle of the conversation, he'd look over at the girl and say, "You know, I can see you feeling me right now. I can see you feeling me, and you drinking and all that, and you're trying to get me drunk. But no matter what we do, I'm not going to let you have sex with me tonight. That's out of the question." Now, he's telling the girl that the girl looking at him like, "What the fuck is this nigga talking about? No going to be no sex, because right now I can't have sex. I just had a dick reduction, and I'm healing up. I'm healing up. I had to cut a couple inches off the beef sack." And the girl be like, "This nigga is crazy." But it definitely would break the ice. See you just tell her. Imagine that in the middle of the conversation, just tell a girl, "Look, I see you're trying to get me drunk, but there's no way you're going to have sex with me tonight." And look, watch her face.
She'll be like, I knew that from the get-go.
She might say that, but then you keep on going. Tell her that, you know, my reason is, though, I'm healing up from a dick reduction.
Yeah, that's funny.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
That's funny, the motherfucker.
Is that the same Rich you were talking about before who used to be like the gigolo?
No, this Rich. Rich was my buddy who used to hang out with older women. And, yeah, you could call that a gigolo. And he would, you know, he would do shit for them. And I'd say, "Rich, I mean, I see they paying, but is this really pimping or hoeing what you're doing? You hear me, Leland? I'm like, are you pimping or hoeing? He said, well, I just call it renting out the beef sack.
At the same time.
I just called it with that. So Masters of Sex, check that out. It's a good show, you know what I'm saying? My wife loves it, and I think it's well written. Another thing is, we talked about it earlier, there's a show called Celebrity Crime Files on TV1 that I've just started becoming a narrator to. And I'd done a bunch of the shows narrating them in the studio, but then I just started watching them, and they're very good shows. When we narrate, we just read the lines. We don't see all the footage. Right. I did one on Tookie, Big Tookie, you know, right. a guy
from L.A.
From L.A. Who
was that the guy who got buried in a Cadillac? Or something
like that? No, he got executed.
Executed.
Went to Death Row.
Got you.
One of the original leaders of the Crips. I did one on my man from Atlanta, Shakir Stewart, who basically started in the Bay, who was a mogul. Very close, similar lives to Chris Lighty, who basically they said, well, at the end of the day, he was running Def Jam.
Right.
And he took over from Jay-Z, and basically they said that he committed suicide. A very similar story to Chris Lighty.
That's crazy.
Two good guys, too.
That's
two
crazy.
Great guys, man.
Yeah, well, definitely.
But you know what it is? It's like, and I did one on the Black Panthers.
When that come on?
It comes on. It's on TV One. I think it comes on Monday nights. But, you know, put it in a DVR. And when we did the Chris Lighty story and I did the one on Shakir, it's like people don't understand, you know, the pressure that goes along with this type of business and stuff. And I don't even think that anybody has never said, you know what, it would be easier if I was just gone.
Nah, no one takes their own goddamn life.
Mickey, I'm not saying whether you do it or not.
But there are people that think about it.
But there's moments when you contemplate it. You know I have. I've been in a situation where I'm like, man, it's so much pressure, man. You just fucking, you know. But of course, it's a big jump from that thought to actually doing it. You know, putting the gun in your hand and all that stuff. But everybody has been in a fucked up, crazy situation where that might just run through your mind. Like, you know, suicide is a very, and now add drugs, add real pressure. Add no one there to talk to. You know, we don't call each other. We men. Just like we talk about with male
health awareness.
Male awareness foundation.
You know,
right.
You need that homie sometimes. You know what I'm saying? You could be fighting with your girl. Man, girl, I'm going to have you motherfucking outside climbing a motherfucking tree, man.
That's true.
You be going through it. Sometimes you got to call your boy and say, man, and just vent.
True.
Because if sometimes when you go into that zone, it's a very dark place. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, these brothers decided that this was the way out. And it's sad.
I can't believe my friend Chris Lighty committed no suicide. That would never sit correct. And having Leland Robinson here from Sugar Hill Records, You knew Chris.
Yeah, great guy.
That wasn't the type of guy that would have did that to himself.
No.
Yeah, but you can't.
Even under pressure.
But the thing about it is, Mick, we don't know what he's going through.
We don't
behind
know
closed
what he's
doors.
Going.
All we see is the good side of Chris, or we've seen everything that was going on in his life, the good side of it. We don't know what was happening on the other side of it.
Yeah, I immediately say that. I always say there's no way that could have happened. But how often do you see, you know, like one of my other partners I just work with.
Chad L. Coleman.
Yeah, so I was talking to Chad Coleman, you know, and without going in too deep, he said he was just on the phone with one of his partners. His partner was having little spousal problems. He talked to him. He said, oh, man, you know, okay. He says, nah, I'm just going to go over there and talk to her, you know. Ends up shooting his wife in the face.
Wow.
Now he's got life. You see, so sometimes what you don't think can happen can happen
really
because
can.
We think we know each other, you know. Oh, Mickey's strong. Somebody say right now, Mickey's fucked up right now, man.
And he has some weak points.
Mickey's fucked.
Everybody has weak points.
Yeah, we got one. We got one there somewhere.
Yeah,
you know.
So
happen,
God bless him. But this is TV, and you know, take a chance. Listen, watch Celebrity Crime Files. I'm the new host on there. I'm the one doing the voiceover, and they have some really, really good topics. You know, I think, you know, it's TV One, so it's connected to BET, but it ain't all that bullshit, monkey shit we hate that they put on. You know, this is not no Love and Hip Hop bullshit.
Oh,
this is
fighting and
throwing
shit.
About something. You're going to learn something if you watch Celebrity Crime Files that'll be helpful. And that was TV. Okay, this is Final Level 22. My man Mick Benzo, Leland Robinson is here, and this is music. And who's better to talk music than, you know, from the first family of hip hop? I mean, the people that really put rap on records in a real way and made it make it to radio. And, you know, people can say what they want about the Rapper's Delight or this, that, or the other, but I know. For me, it was the first record I heard that made me want to rap.
Well, this is important for y'all out there listeners. We want y'all to really tune in and check out my man Leland Robinson, right? His mother's name is Sylvia Robinson. Rest in peace. She's very she's been gone, but haven't been forgotten. His dad is gone, but not forgotten. And he just recently lost his baby brother, Scooch Robinson. And that's, you know, he's gone but not forgotten. But he's up here on the Final Level podcast because we want to express to y'all about music in the hip-hop world, how it officially got on the radio. That's real big.
What was it like for you? I mean, you were a kid. And what are your first memories?
Well, I was, I was in high school at the time when the record came out. And, you know, all of a sudden, it was on the radio stations all over the place. And kids like, yo, that's your family? That's your family? And it was just like, I was like, yeah. But it was a great situation growing up in the music industry and growing up and watching that record blow up as big as it really did. And I can all say it was a great experience.
You became a producer?
Yeah, I produced a few records also. I did a record with called Miami Vice for the television show. I did a record with Busy Bee. Mm-hmm. I did a few records. I did some things with Mel. I did a lot of scratching, a lot of the records.
Oh, you were DJing too?
Yeah. Back then, it was Vicious Lee.
Viciously. I like that.
It was Vicious Lee.
You had a record out too.
Yeah, I did a few records. I did the record with the West Street Mob called Breakdance Electric Boogie. I did all the scratching on that. I actually assisted Flash into the record... Wheels of Steel.
See, this is
that
big.
He did.
This is big.
You know, he was like.
Did you have anything to do with the Funky 4+1?
No, I was too young then.
Your parents had them on television. They were the first rap group on Saturday Night Live. I understand. First rap group.
Yeah.
From Sugar Hill like label was Funky 4+1 on Saturday Night Live.
I think you're correct, Mickey.
And you went on to work at, I want to say Motown. You worked at Motown before?
Yeah, I bumped into Kedar Massenburg. We was at the jewelry store one day, and he asked me what was I doing. I told him I was doing a lot of producing for a lot of people. I produced some records for Tyrese. I did some records for Case. I did some records for Charlie Wilson. I did some records for Mona Lisa. A lot of artists I was recording back there. I had like 6-7 producers.
Did you have your own studio?
Yeah, I actually did. And it's a story to that, too. Back then, you know, when I finally decided to get into the industry, it was like, you know, things was real slow.
Mm-hmm.
And I kept going to this music store called Musically Yours in Hackensack. And I kept saying, I'm going to buy this. So finally, after going there about 10, 15 times, the guy turns around and says, look, man, what do you want? So I says, I'm going to come back and get this stuff. It's just a matter of time. But I'm trying to do it all on my own.
Mm-hmm.
He says, listen, what do you want? He gave me $65,000 worth of equipment.
What?
Gave it to me.
No money down.
Listen to me. After coming there for months and months and months, he gave me $65,000 worth of studio equipment and sent it over to the studio, and I built my first studio on my own. Not with mother, not my father, me by myself. So I got started there. I got some producers, and then I started rocking and rolling in. Did the Best Man soundtrack, some songs in there, and everything. So now.
Can I ask you a question, though?
Sure.
What did you do for him? Did you ever? I mean, what did you? Did you ever hit him back? Or did you ever bless him? I mean,
I'm gonna get into that.
Okay, yeah. Because what?
So I finally made some money and paid him back. And when I paid him back, I asked him. My exact words to him was, "Why did you do what you did when you did it?"
Mm-hmm.
And he said, "What?" I said, why did you give me the equipment and stuff? He said, because in life, someone gave him a chance, and I felt that you were that person to give a chance to.
How about that?
And gave me the chance, and that's when I started making music and started producing for different artists.
But you know what? The fly shit was you paid him back.
Absolutely. Yep.
And you know, I always tell people, the person that helps you, that's not who you fuck. That's you right. know, and people will take that, and that'll be the last thing. And that's a big show of character. You made sure he got that back.
Yeah, of course. And I bought everything. I didn't care whether it was more money at Sam Ash or, you know, or if it was less money.
Right.
And he was charging me more money. I still bought everything I could buy from him because he was the one who initiated everything for me to actually get my start.
What was his name?
Eddie. He owns a store called Musically Yours. He was in Rochelle Park at the time.
Is he now still alive?
He's in Hackensack now. I spoke to him about...
That's fly.
A month ago.
That's hard.
This is crazy. I spoke to him a month ago, and I called him. I said, hey, Eddie, what's going on? And the first thing he does is call me Starsky, because I brought Starsky over there to him, and he heard Love Buck Starsky DJ, and so he'd be like, Starsky, what's going on? So I said, Eddie, I'm teaching at Bergen Community College. I'm doing it, you know, for the kids, just teaching the kids everything about the music industry, you know. So I says, Eddie, I need a set of turntables with a, you know, mixer and everything and Serato to teach these kids how to DJ.
Mm-hmm.
He said, no problem, take it. Not one charge,
still,
no fee, no nothing.
Still friends.
So anything I do, if I can turn anybody on to this guy, I would turn anybody on to this guy because he gave me a fair shot. He didn't have to.
All right, now that's Eddie in Hackensack, but don't go in there thinking he gonna give you shit free.
You might go there for 6 months straight like I did.
Don't do that. Don't do that. You know what I'm saying? He gave Leland something free and also, stuff, and that's a good man.
Also, Lee, your moms and dad had their own recording, real big studio in Jersey, right?
Yeah, well, they built the studio. It was called, I forgot the name of the room. It was called, some company out of California came in and built it. And actually, the police... and big white groups used to record in there.
Oh, so it wasn't just Sugar Hill?
No. Artists it was bigger than that. It was okay.
Well, I mean,
you already said white groups, real rock groups, money.
I don't remember all the correct names,
right?
But there was only two studios like this in the world. One was in California, and one was here in New Jersey, and that's the one we had. And before Sugar Hill, there was a lot of white groups that recorded there. And, you know, my mother used to work with Quincy Jones.
Your mom used to work with The Moments?
The Moments, Quincy. I have pictures of her with her and Quincy, her, Stevie. My mother found Stevie Wonder, his house.
Oh,
his
shit.
His first house in Alpine.
Oh,
you know, so she used to have a whole bunch of people coming in out of the studio before my time.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So that's what it is.
Hey, this is music, man. I'm feeling it. Sugar Hill Records, man. You know, Miss Rob will always be missed. She treated everybody that I know good. She treated me good. So.
You know, they're now doing her movie also now. This lady, Paula Wagner. Okay. She's a big movie producer who did Mission Impossible.
Okay.
She just picked up the rights for the movie, so she's working on the movie.
To do what? Sylvia Robinson movie?
The Sylvia Robinson movie.
Wow. It should be a movie.
Sugar Hill Story.
The story? That's hot.
Yeah, it's Tom Cruise's lady, right?
Yep.
Nice.
That's hot.
Yeah.
Well, that's hot, man. Well, it's an honor. You know, it's funny though, because in hip hop, certain people are like royalty. You dig what I'm saying? So, you know, you meet so many people, and they go, "Okay, who's that? Da-da-da-da-da-da. Oh, that's Grand Wizard Theodore, huh?" And you turn around, like, "Okay, that's somebody who had something to do with the creation." So, you know, when I first met you, and they went, "Well, that's you know." From the Robinson family, I'm like, well, you got to respect that because that was, you know, it all has to do with what I am. You know, if rap hadn't came, who the fuck knows what I would have ended up doing. So one thing leads to the next thing. And if you don't respect how it all happened, then,
They actually gave us, like, you know, that seal that says official for United States of America, the president. Y'all gave it the seal for hip hop, really. Even though we started in the Bronx, you guys out here made sure it got national exposure. Right. Y'all got it on the radio first.
Well, they took it to the next level.
That was a task force, too. That was a task force.
Y'all took it to the radio first. And Sugar Hill Gang was the biggest fucking record out, no hands down, to anybody to say anything. That was the record of all time.
That's the record that set it off. And I think the next people that really had something to do with it would have to be Def Jam and Rush.
Yeah.
Who took it to that next level.
Next level,
When Run DMC and them guys decided we're going to start doing stadiums and big shit. It was like, Okay. There's moments in hip hop where it just jumped.
Absolutely.
And it kept jumping and stuff. But, you know, like I say, I was in the Army and, you know, Rappers Delight came out, and on the B side, it was just the instrumental. And the first day I heard that record, I was trying to rap on the other side of the record. Like, Lord Jamar called it the do-it-yourself version. Curtis Blow did the same thing. He had a record in the B side. It said, do it yourself.
Do it yourself.
And you trying to rhyme, and you like, how do they do this shit? You know, like, trying to do it. So now, here we are, it's 2000, almost 15. What's going on in Leland's life right now?
Well, I've still been working with my mom's and my father's publishing company, still running that. And I'm doing a little outside things. I opened up a restaurant in Englewood where Ice-T did come to.
Yeah, just closed that down. Right.
And I'm working with this wine and liquor company called 20 Grand now. They was the first one to have a vodka cognac to hit the streets. So I'm working with them doing a little promotion.
They trying to get people drunk. You're talking about a vodka and a cognac in one bottle.
In one bottle, yeah. Damn. And they have their own vodka, and they have a rosé vodka also as well, too.
Rosé vodka.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm looking at it. The bottles is real sexy right here. This is cool. You know what I'm saying? This is, you know, the thing of it is, me and Mickey, we in Dallas, we did a little liquor scenario, but the thing with liquor is there's so much liquor out there.
Yeah, absolutely.
So to rise to the top and, you know, to get that Puff Daddy Chirac thing going, it just costs lots and lots and lots of money. Yeah.
I don't think it's going to happen no more like that.
Yeah.
For nobody else to blow it up like that again.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody has their slot with it, and he has his slot. And the crazy thing about it...
Well, I heard Jay-Z just bought Ace of Spades.
Yeah. But do a lot of people drink it?
Yeah. No.
Yeah, well...
They don't.
Well, you don't know.
It's too expensive.
But you just don't know.
Maybe we're not buying it. Maybe there are people that are buying it.
Yeah, and you don't know. It's like he just bought it once they put that promotional shit behind it, you know what I'm saying? Because... The promotion took Chirac and flew it right past all the Grey Gooses and all that. So once you promote it and you connect it to the right people and you do that marketing correctly, you can make it the thing.
The thing, yeah.
The thing. You can push it past Cristal and all those other high-end.
He probably That's can cool. make that work.
I ain't mad at him.
No, yeah. Not at all.
How much does that champagne cost per bottle?
Oh, it could be $500 or $600. But damn. See, right now you're in a culture of the fakers and the fronters. Yeah. So the kid that can't pay his rent will buy that bottle of champagne and go out and take a picture with it. It's, you know, it's even like the Beats headsets. It's like they're status symbols. You know, when we were growing up, it was some Air Jordan sneakers. Different things have become status symbols, and champagne in a club and different bottles. You know, that's what kids do. When we were growing up, people were getting high. Now they pop bottles. That's the new thing. We popping bottles. Who's in the club spending, like I tell my son, wasting the most money trying to look fly.
Right.
You dig what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's you know, he's like, oh, Dad, I was out with my friend last night and he spent 20 grand on bottles. I'm like, and then y'all pissed that out, right? You should have bought a watch, dummy. Yeah, yeah. If you had a watch, your watch would be still sitting on your goddamn wrist the next day. You know, but the liquor business is very lucrative, and 20 grand got that look, though. Look at it right here. They got the look.
That's cool. It's cool. I like it. I like the look.
Where can people find this?
They're in a lot of liquor stores now.
Mm-hmm. You guys have a website?
They do have a website as well. Just that, you know what it is? They just they don't have that, you know, that person to put with the liquor. You know what I mean? They don't have
they don't have a face
for the brand yet. But on their own, I was told that in Georgia is doing really well.
Oh, cool.
And New York is finally picking up. You know what I mean? So they slow walking it, but hopefully they're trying to put some faces to it to make it really happen for the company.
Well, good luck with them. Good luck with them. But you know, the liquor business is big.
It's hard.
Money.
Too. It's real hard.
Big money. I mean, even back in the day, I did an energy drink, and we were rolling and we were doing
liquid ice.
We were trying to get it in places. They were like, "Oh no, Red Bull has us exclusive." I mean, what do you mean exclusive? Oh no, Red Bull gives us, you know, $50,000 a year not to have anything.
It's a holy brand. Yep.
Us.
Damn.
So I'm like, big bank takes little bank. You know what I'm saying? They're throwing lots of money around out there. So, you know, when you're trying to get your liquor into a place, they're like, "Well, you know, Grey Goose is paying us a lot of money just to sell Grey Goose.
Yep.
So it gets heavy out there. You got to have your paper together. But God bless 20 grand. Maybe, you know, that'll be the next thing. You know what I'm saying? You know, I ain't afraid of liquor business. You know? Yeah. They told me, they said, well, I heard you don't drink. I say, well, I sip.
That's right.
I don't drink, but that's right. Sip.
Me too.
I have a little sip. So what else? Anything else you want to talk about right now while you're here? You just want to fuck around with us on the podcast.
I'm with y'all with the podcast. Let's go.
Well, we're glad you're here, man. We're
glad to have you, Leland Robinson, for real, man.
I'm glad to be here.
Respect what y'all put together for the call of hip-hop, man. Y'all did a great job right here in the state of New Jersey. That did a good damn job, man.
Thank you, Mickey. Well, I was too young then.
Yeah, but your parents did a great job, and y'all are still carrying on with it, man, and we appreciate that.
And even people that aren't really familiar super with hip-hop,
they can Google this.
And still quote Rapper's Delight.
Oh, yeah. The Message. Melly Mel's Wreck, all of the Furious Five, and Treacherous Three, and Busy B, and, I mean, Funky Four. I mean, it just had so much. Y'all had so much over here in New Jersey. Yep. Right in Inglewood, right? Inglewood, New Jersey?
Inglewood, New Jersey. They named the street after my mom, actually.
Oh, and that was special.
That's fly.
Yeah, that was special. They just they did it this summer. They named West Street Sylvie Robinson Place.
Oh, that's special.
Yep.
Yeah, I thought I had a street named after me, but it said garbage here.
See, you know what? That's what I'm saying. I hate that you got to pass away to get something named after you be acknowledged. That's corny too, sometimes, man.
Right.
You know,
Well,
why you can't do it while I'm here so I can see it at least. You know,
drive down.
I spoke to a lot of those people, Mick, and like the BETs and all that, and I'm like, listen, man, you know, y'all give all these people a lot of credit, but y'all have never ever really to the person who started this, because without her starting this, you wouldn't have a job with the hip hop. There wouldn't be no A&R hip hop. There wouldn't be no.
Wouldn't be nothing. What's their answer?
When are we gonna just to say, yo, let's just give this lady her rights?
What's their answer?
What did they say?
Oh, we're gonna think about doing something next year. We're gonna think about, and it never.
See,
happens.
Now this is good. Because
that's one of your answers.
It never happens. Good.
Did they say talk to my publicist?
They said talk to my publicist.
No.
That's bullshit.
Yeah, this is good. This is good conversation right here on the Final Level Podcast with Mick Benzo and Ice-T. You see how he said he acts a company that's playing hip hop and consider themselves Black Entertainment TV. When will they honor his mom for doing what she did? And once again, they come back with the old monkey in a wrench. We'll think about it. That's disrespectful. But guess what, though?
What about the Grammys?
They get their turn.
What about the Grammys?
They get their turn.
Same thing. Same thing goes for the Grammys.
They get their turn.
Matter of fact, when we took Rapper's Delight to the radio station, they said they're not playing it.
Yeah. I won a Grammy for rapping, but I rap with Quincy Jones. See, we kind of got in the back door.
Yeah,
me, Mel. Me, Mel, Kumo D, Kane, all of us got
that. Was a bad record, too.
That was back on the block, baby. Quincy Jones.
Quincy Jones.
But still, it was a rapper doing the record with Quincy Jones, right. Not just Michael Jackson.
Right.
So rappers do have a place in history, and y'all got to start acknowledging that BET and Grammy.
Well, the first word on the record was Ice, let me kick my credentials. It was no Quincy Jones singing.
Yeah.
It was me.
A player, South Central LA,
home of the body bag.
You want to die, wear the wrong color rap.
So we didn't cut it for Quincy. I came in gangster rapping right off the top.
Right.
And we got a Grammy with it.
And you ain't do nothing else but be yourself on that record.
I bet you they don't even realize how important this conversation was. Google Sugar Hill Records, Sugar Hill Label. Google it. Read up on it. Figure it out. Royalty is in the building. Leland Robinson. Damn.
And that was music. Back here on the Fine Level Podcast, this is movies. Now, last week we were talking about movies with Jamie Jassen. We've been talking about a couple of movies, and I finally got a chance to see them. The first one was John Wick with Keanu Reeves. Go see this movie.
How good was it?
I'm going to tell you how good it is. You know, I'm building a new house, been building it. I might move in next month. It'll be the first movie I'm going to buy for my house.
I'm going to buy that shit in Blu-ray. You can't buy that if you're not going to buy The Equalizer.
The Equalizer is the next one. But John Wick is doper than The Equalizer. Let me tell you, Keanu. I work with Keanu in a movie called Johnny Mnemonic. This nigga in this movie, they kill his dog, right? What happens is his wife dies, unexpectedly. He loved her to death, and she just gives him a dog, and she says, you know, this is who to have to love instead of me. You don't know he's a killer, and these fools decide to steal his car and take, and they kill his dog. This motherfucker, you talking about going on one? He goes on one. And the way it's choreographed, I mean, you hip to John Woo, you know, mm-hmm, all the old mm-hmm. killer stuff. It's to the next level. It's not CGI'd. And yeah. Keanu is getting off. Like, he's shooting a motherfucker this way, boom, shooting him this way. While that guy's falling, he's hitting him again. Bam. Boom. He's dive rolling, catching people, and then while they rolling, shooting them. Boom, boom. And he, there's a scene where he's walking through a club just dumping on motherfuckers. Boom. Blam. Blam.
Your kind of movie.
It's my kind of movie. Keanu Reeves plays his part. You know, he's really removed and cold in it. But it's a guy movie, and it's very well done. I really enjoyed it. After that, went and saw Equalizer. Luckily, my wife, she likes guy movies. She likes the grimy stuff, you know. I don't see why a woman wouldn't like it, because the guys in it are sexy and the men are doing male shit. You know what mm-hmm, I'm saying? So mm-hmm. the girl's like, fuck it. Let's go see some tough guy shit.
Right.
So she sat. We went and saw Denzel in The Equalizer, directed by Antoine Fuqua, who directed Training Day, a brother. Mm. So
that's
so
a bad movie, Training yeah, Day.
And Denzel, once again, Denzel's 59 years old.
And still doing it.
Getting it in.
Well, yeah. The moral of the story, when you say you watch John Wick, in all honesty, people really, really, really care about the animals.
As oh, yeah. They did, as
if they did. No, no, no.
Real talk.
You watch the movie, but people, you, Ice-T, really care about Spartacus and Maximus.
Oh, no, I
if
lose
someone
it.
Does something with those dogs blatantly, intentionally,
yeah, they definitely,
they're going to get it.
They got to get it.
And that's being honest, because those are really some people kids, man.
They're part of your family.
You know, what about you, Lee? You got one?
Don't fuck with
dog?
My
dog.
Yeah.
I got a dog and two pigs.
Do you love
it? Yeah, he got some pigs. What'd you say?
What you love, a dog better or the pigs, man?
Oh, man, I love my dog, man. I love
but you
my
got
dog.
Two pigs. You got, honestly, Leland Robinson got two pigs.
Two pot-belly pigs.
That's dope.
Like, seriously?
Seriously, two pop belly pigs.
You hear him, Coco?
You got
two
pictures of him?
I have a pot belly pig, and it goes around the house and it squeals. Does he squeal?
Only when he's hungry.
What does he eat?
Pig food? No, we don't give him no bacon.
He's not a cannibal.
What's pig food?
What is pig
they
food?
Got, they got special pig food, you know?
Like, where do you buy it?
At where do we get that food from? The pet store? They have a pet store that sells it.
Are you serious or you joking?
At the pet store?
Yeah.
Are you serious or you joking?
I'm serious, man. Two pigs.
Now, I heard a story about people that are trying to buy these little bitty pigs.
Right.
I don't know if this is a true story, but they're called teacup pigs or something. But the people ain't selling them. They're just selling them real baby pigs.
Right.
And the damn pig grow to be like 500 pounds in the house. It just never stops growing. But by then, they done fell in love with the pig.
Oosh, nah.
So they got a big-ass pig in the house. His are pot bellies.
Pot belly, yeah.
Next time you come around me, bring a pig. You promise? No, when we move, I'm going to have Lena come over and we're going to. I need to see a pig, man. I like that. That's fly. I like wild animals, crazy shit.
Yeah.
When we were in Africa, we met a cheetah up close.
You met a cheetah?
Yeah, a real live cheetah. And they told us, they said, cheetahs don't eat people. They we're not in their prey scale. Like, they might hurt a child. But then they would never attack anything bigger than them.
Wow.
So the cheetah came on the bus with us, and we were petting it, and it meowed like a cheetah, like a big ass cheetah, the world's fastest animal. This thing was just like a big ass house cat.
Wow!
And they've never killed a person. They're just, you know, and I wouldn't put a kid in front of it because now that looks like something it could probably knock down and kill. But it was kind of dope. I was like, that shit was kind of dope. Yeah. But anyway, back to our movies. John Wick, the moral of the story is do not fuck with people's animals. Keanu Reeves got it in. I recommend it. It really video game-ish. It has all kinds of video game type vibes to it. Like there's a hotel where all the assassins go, but they can't kill each other in there. There's a rule. But it's a fun, two fun movies for guys. This is not the girls' week for movies. This is for guys. Go see The Equalizer and John Wick. You won't be sorry. And that was Movies. Yo, this is Fine Level Podcast number 22, and this is games. You know, I've been back playing games, Alex.
Awesome.
I've been playing. There's one game called The Evil Within, which I've been playing. I think I talked about it. It's made by the same people who made the first Resident Evil.
Damn.
I played the shit out of this game. You be shooting motherfuckers in the head with shotguns. People say, "Why, T, you play video games?" I said, "What wouldn't I like about shooting people in the head with shotguns?"
What part you don't understand?
Oh, yeah. And now Advanced Warfare has come out with Call of Duty. And I just got it the other day. Somebody from Xbox sent me, because I've been in a lot of Xbox games. They sent me the game. I took it to my work. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to play it. But I got a 360 on my at work.
It didn't work.
So I had to download it off the internet for $69 or something from my Xbox 360. Now I have one over there for my Xbox One because I like to play here and I like to play when I get to work. At first, I didn't think. Here's my review of Advanced Warfare. First, I didn't think I was going to like it because I saw that the people could jump around. I thought it was going to be more like Halo. Halo, you fly and jump around. I'm not really into that. I want it to be normal. This game is dope. You don't really jump. You got like a jetpack where you can hit it and it makes you jump a little bit higher, but you can't fly. You've got these packs that allow you to come off of high places and lower yourself. It's a lot of gadgets, and I'm only playing the campaign. I'm not the kind of gamer that gets on the games and immediately goes to multiplayer.
Yeah, nah.
To try to get my ranking up really, really quick. By the time I start playing multiplayer, everybody else is already prestige.
Right.
They've already have played the game too much. I want to learn the game, and I love playing the campaign. I really would advise getting Advanced Warfare. It feels good. It's fun. They got a lot of cool gadgets, a lot of cool upgrades. It has an ill learning curve. It's not exactly like the rest of the Call of Duty games, but it's fun to learn as you play. It is a first-person shooter. The narrative is dope, and I think Call of Duty's back on the right track. I think that, you know, this is the game that most of the first-person shooters, you know, call home.
Yeah.
You know, and I can't really wait to get a chance to sit down and really get in and then fire my clan up and get out there and run and gun.
I can't wait so I can go home and play the fucking ping pong.
I'm still playing in television from 1980 basketball.
He's the new guy. You know he loves these new shit.
Don't
he
pay any attention games. To the non-gamers in the room right now.
I gave you and Little Ice Skyrim a minute ago.
Okay.
That's my favorite game.
Skyrim, and Ice was playing Skyrim on the tour.
Yeah.
But see, that's an RPG.
It is, but it's so dope.
You know what an RPG non-gamers are called role-playing games.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So what happens is during the game, you have to stop and it gives you all these options. You like got to talk. Like it says, say yes, say no, hit him in the face, leave, give him the cryptic claw or some shit.
Yeah, that's some shit Alex
would like. It slows down. It slows down. You know, I'm like,
you just want to shoot people. Hold on, Alex. Nah, my guy's talking about a real good game, and here you go with the...
No, that's a good game, but it's a different type of game.
I'm like a nerdy motherfucker who, like, sits and watches every Hobbit movie.
We can
and,
tell.
Like, that's my shit. Tell. I'm a nerd through and through.
Yeah, I'm more of a geek.
Yeah.
So, you know, and we always say, nerds talk about it, geeks can do it.
Well, I'm a geek.
You're a tech geek.
I'm a tech geek.
Right, you're a tech geek.
But you're a nerd. Did you go to Comic-Con?
No, I wouldn't go to a Comic-Con.
You didn't put on your leotards and walk all the way through Manhattan in boots?
No, I couldn't do that, but I will play Skyrim.
Okay.
We don't have a problem. Let's make one thing clear.
We're not haters.
The Fine Level Podcast, we represent the nerds.
Yeah.
Yes,
we represent the geeks. We represent the furries. We represent Comic-Con people. We represent all of them.
Yes, yeah. We do.
Because why? It doesn't offend me. If it's your thing, you do it. But I will define how far I go into those realms, Ice-T, personally. You know, you ain't going to catch me in a rabbit suit.
Okay? No. Hold on.
Here's the thing, though.
I know what. Well, let me say this Halloween that just passed, I seen a guy, I don't know if you ever go to clubs and always see
the creepy guy.
Guy standing next to the bathroom trying to bother the girl. He dressed up in that shit, though.
I was the creepy guy in the club. That's Halloween. I said, that's different. Everybody dress up on Halloween. If I'm not, you know, like when they go to the Trekkie conventions, these people really dress like, you know, Chewbacca. And, you know, they're going in there in the Star Wars shit and all that.
They go to movies like that now.
And you know what? I'm not mad at it. Everybody has a good time. And the girls in there, one good thing about Comic-Con, all the girls look sexy.
Yeah.
The girls look sexy.
The few of them that are there.
Oh, there was a lot. I seen them walking because they come and walking down 34th Street getting into it. But anyway, this is games.
But can I say this, though? I feel like the only reason you're not into Elder Scrolls is because you know you'd like it. And that shit's addictive.
No, I'm not into it because I want to shoot the guns. I'm in it because I like the blood. I like the shoot. I like the violence. This is my outlet to become violent and kill shit without going to jail. I told you this. I have a bloodlust. I want to hurt things.
You kill things in the game.
Do you?
Yeah, you kill everything.
Slowly?
No.
Okay. All right, well, okay. I mean, I want to gut some shit, you know? Oh. That's just my thing, and I understand. Everyone has to understand their problems and their shit, and this is like therapy for me, you know? Because in real life, you know, things bother me, and I really want to go hurt things, but
take
I don't.
The aggression out on
and
the
I
games,
play
man,
video.
Have a good game.
It's
man.
Therapy.
That's good.
It's therapy. You take my games away, and I'm gonna end up in a jumpsuit. And that was games. Speaking of nerdy role playing things, you can get my new Dungeons and Dragons book, Comrades at Odds, A Tale from the Legend of Drizzt, on audible.com. Audible is a longtime supporter of the podcast, and I'm a big fan of audiobooks, as they're easy, convenient, and better to listen to in the car than awful radio stations. If you're at all interested in audiobooks, you need to check out Audible. Audible is the world's leading provider for audiobooks with over 150,000 titles to choose from. You can even listen to audiobooks anywhere. They have whisper sync technology that makes sure you never lose your place when you switch devices. It even lets you switch between listening to an audiobook and reading an ebook on your Kindle. You can get my autobiography, Ice, from South Central to Hollywood, and that's definitely the business. All you guys need to check that out. For a free audiobook and a 30-day trial, go to audible.com/iced. That's audible/iced. You'll be saving money and you'll be helping to keep the podcast free. Thanks again to Audible. This next segment is one of the favorites of Final Level Podcast. Everybody loves this one. And this is called I'm not a hater, but I hate shit. And we know what a hater is. A hater is an envious person who's mad at you for whatever reason and gets, you know, just hates you because really, I guess they wished you were you. But without being a hater, there's still things that can bother you. And this is I'm not a hater, but I hate shit. You know what I hate, Mick?
What do you hate this week,
I hate
man?
Daylight saving time.
Well, all we could do is turn the clock back. No, we spring up. and fall
it's
back.
It's dumb shit.
Why?
Now, the shit was invented for the farmers. It was invented. It's not it's not daylight savings time. It's daylight saving time. And it's supposed to help the farmers and some. Fuck that. I live in New York City. Ain't no motherfuckers growing corn, okay? What it does is it makes it so I have to wake up in the dark and go to sleep in the dark. You did.
It get dark at 4 o'clock,
and it's dark at like 7 a.m. in the morning when I'm waking up. So I'm like turned into fucking Bela Lugosi around this motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, it's dark, right? And then if you work and you work indoors, right?
You come out.
You never see the daylight.
That's right. Yeah.
You know. So now it's getting dark now at 5 o'clock
in the afternoon.
Right. I hate that shit, man. I don't know. I don't really. I mean, so I guess if you don't get up early, do you get up early, Leland?
Sometimes. So I got to take these kids to school in the morning. So
it's dark.
It's dark.
Yeah.
Right. And then right after they get off from school, it's dark.
Yeah.
So I really don't get it. It's not. It's only benefit to us is being in what I do in television is when we shoot exteriors during the day, they have to wrap earlier because we call it they're losing light.
Yeah.
Right.
They don't do it in Arizona.
They don't do daylight savings in Arizona?
No, in Arizona it never changes.
Really?
Wow, I never knew that.
Yeah. Am I right, Coco? What? No daylight saving time in Arizona?
No.
See?
So your time don't change at all?
No, it just stays the same. And so it might be a small pet peeve, but I believe there's millions of people out there listening to this podcast that feel the same way, getting up in the dark and coming home from work in the dark sucks balls.
You know what I just saw? The idea of daylight savings was first created by Benjamin Franklin.
The fuck was he doing?
But why?
Let me go pee.
The first people to propose the idea were Benjamin Franklin, George Hudson, and William Willett. These men all introduced the idea around 1974.
Not 1974.
Or 1784, sorry. and you were right about the farmers, and then it said some stuff about World War II.
Benjamin
Franklin. To conserve coal, because they did it to conserve coal during the Second World War.
That's some crazy shit.
Yeah.
To conserve coal, and we're still are we conserving coal right now?
No, but it says here.
Oh, shit.
It increases. It actually decreases the country's electricity consumption by 1% because of daylight savings.
I'm not a hater,
but I hate shit,
and I hate fucking daylight saving time. Hey, this is Final Level Podcast number 22 with Leland Robinson in the building. We got Alex from Paragon who makes this all happen and Mick Benzo. And this segment is called Philosophy. Now, Philosophy segment is brought to you by my Twitter page, which is at Final Level, where I do this thing called the Daily Game. Y'all already know what the Daily Game is. And one of the most recent Daily Game was Under Promise, Overproduce. And that's a motto that I go by. You can call it under promise, over deliver. But this is a business motto that I think people should take with them in their life, and I'll explain why. When you start off talking to people and you promise really, really, really big things, and then you bring them a good result, but not as big as what you promised, it looks like a failure.
Yep.
And what you're doing is you're setting yourself up to fail. What you have to do is, you know, if my man says, well, how much you think we gonna get, I say, I don't know, you know, we can make $100. If I bring him $300, he's gonna look at me like I'm the biggest success in the world. You feel me, Leland?
Yep.
And people tend to promise too much. Now, you're a businessman. Do you agree with this?
You're 100% right. I've had people say, oh, I'm going to bring you $100,000, and all of a sudden they come with $10,000, and oh, this is a start. But that's not what you told me from the beginning.
So all they had to do was say, I'm going to get you some money. It's going to be some money. And you might have been happy with the $10,000.
I'd have been happy with $5,000 if he told me he was going to get me some money.
Right.
You know, but the thing about it is, don't tell me you're going to bring me $100 and bring me $10,000.
because you set yourself up for failure.
Absolutely.
And a lot of times when you're doing businesses out here, you have all these big plans. Learn to just hold it. Don't speak on it till it's locked in, till it's done. Like we say, till the check's in the mail, in the bank, and has cleared. Because if you talk too soon, you know, you're always going to come off as a failure because most of the stuff in business does fall through. Now, Alex, you're in the business,
yeah.
You know. So what you do is you say, I got some things in the works. How do you say it when you're not sure?
You know what? This piece of advice is something that I'm definitely working on right now. You know, I feel like at the end of the day, you can only learn so much by, you know, going through some things yourself.
Right.
You know, especially with something like podcasting, it's so new that it's impossible for me to really go to an artist and say, like, you're going to make this much money or you're going to do this. All I can say is, like, hey, you know, this is going to be an excellent brand building opportunity. It's super fun. You can do it from your house. And how you get paid is off how many downloads you get.
Right. So you can say you can potentially make this based on what you can bring in.
Yeah.
The worst thing is say you're going to make $1 million this year.
Yeah, unless you can guarantee that.
and who can guarantee much of anything in life? If I could have got 10% of what I've been promised in my career, you know, we'd be sitting in some penthouse up in Manhattan someplace with people bringing us hors d'oeuvres right now. You know what I'm saying? Just 10%, because people come in, they have these big goals. And a lot of times people that are making promises don't even know the business they're talking about.
Yeah.
You know, they're like saying, oh, well, this, you know, I used to do deals with people when they would be like, okay, well, Ice, well, this is what we're going to do. You know, we're going to make, you're going to, I guarantee, you know, we'll make $1 million this year with this plan. I say, well, if that's the case, why don't you give me $300,000 right now? Give it to me. We'll put it in escrow. Give it to me, you know, and make it recoupable. Wait a minute, you know, we said we're gonna make a million.
So why
give me
300?
Right, they quick.
Backtracking.
And then we'll you know, we'll recoup it as we make it. So stop promising, you know, don't guarantee it. If I don't want to get in it on just the belief that it has the potential to make it, do not promise things, even in a small job. You know, sometimes, you know, when people always say, well, how long is it going to take to get to your house? I'll be there in 10 minutes. Nigga, you have not even left your house.
Sounds like me, Ice.
You have never even left your house. Just learn to be honest. Say, man, you know what? I haven't even left my house, man. It's going to take an hour. You know why? Because that'll give me a chance to counter. You know what? Okay, I can do something up till the time you get here. But when you tell me 10 minutes, you freeze me. You fucking me.
That's right. Yeah.
It doesn't help. You don't, you know, be honest with everything you do. You know, I'm when people come to me to talk to me about business, I'm very negative because I know how difficult it is to make money.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, man, it's going to be a grind, man. We might. It could. If it jumps off, the sky's the limit, but it has to jump off.
Right.
Yeah. And you know, people, oh, well, this is going to be a hit record. You're a producer. This is a hit. This is the bomb. I'm like, it ain't a bomb till it goes off. It ain't gone off yet. This is your theory of what it's going to do. It's so many things that have to happen for this to be a successful. The only thing that's guaranteed is the money you're about to reach in your pocket and pull out and hand to me at that moment. So this is a motto to take with you. It's a little bit of philosophy. When I call it game, but it's just it's a very good work ethic. Under promise, overproduce. If you always give the person more than you promised them, you'll look like the biggest fucking winner. You know what I'm saying? If you know you're going to bring me $1,000, say, Ice, I don't know, it's $200-$300. I don't know. And if you got me thinking that and you hand me $1,000,
I'm even happier.
Oh my God.
I'm happier. Happier.
Yeah. I'm like, whoa, is that what happened? You know, but sometimes we're so tempted to just to forecast it, and we want to talk too soon.
Sometimes they get excited. That's all. They just excited. Yeah, just slow it down.
And the problem is that everybody's full of shit. You know, it's not like it's just like small little people. It's like how many companies out there just make a huge living just because they inflate their stock prices. And it's like, I look at it like this too. It's like, we have to be, you have to be really honest with people about what you can control and what you can't.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's part of it, you know, and like for me personally, like, you know, this is definitely something I've struggled with a lot.
Hey, look, Alex, I can make you a radio. Yeah. I can make you a record. Me and Leland can go in and we can make you a hot ass record.
Yeah.
We don't control radio. We don't control.
Can't tell me it's a hit.
Who's going to play it?
Yeah.
Now, we can make a half ass record, but if radio jumps on it, it's going to hit. So we don't have that control. Like I always said, yo, if you had somebody that ran Clear Channel, if you're sleeping with the girl who's programming for Clear Channel, that's like having a connection to the biggest. I mean, that means anything we put goes on the radio. Oh, man, we're through with money. Yeah, we're done. Exactly. But that connection doesn't exist. Not that I'm Jay-Z might have that connection. Yeah. I don't know who got that connection, right. But we don't have that.
But I look at it like, I look at it like, you know, I might not be able to make a podcast like, you know, be the biggest shit in the world necessarily. But I can be that guy that anytime you or Mick needs something, I'm there.
But your intentions are to be the biggest guy.
Yeah,
yeah, but my intentions are to be the best.
You didn't promise us that.
You haven't promised us anything that we're looking forward to.
That's why we're still in business with you. You told us your podcast revenue will be based on how many people you can get to listen to.
And those are truthful words.
And I told you I bust my ass and I go above and beyond on it. And at the end of the day, that's all you can do.
Well, that's why you're sitting at this table.
Yeah,
the people that have overpromised ain't sitting at this table.
Other than that, your ass wouldn't be here, Alex.
But at the same time, too, I also want to make a little caveat that just, you know, even when you are successful and you know, people look at you like you're successful, like, I'm sure people look at everybody at this table like, oh, y'all, like, you've made it everywhere you go, even if you don't necessarily feel it all the time. Like, do you, like Ice, do you feel like a rock star everywhere?
I don't know what a rock star really feels like, but I think people look at me and say, Ice, you've had a real degree of success. I don't feel like an artist is trying to do it. I think people know, well, Ice, you got the gold records, you've done it, you kind of did what people wanted to do in hip hop. So I feel like a success as far as that goes. Whether I got a hit
emotionally
record,
though.
Yeah, emotionally, yeah. Okay. Yeah. I feel like you accomplished what you set out to do. And I'm not living in no big mansion or nothing, but I achieved the accolades that I went after. And, you know, that's why I'm very calm and cool and just happy with my life. And, you know, I just, when I started rapping, I just wanted to be a rapper. I just wanted to be named amongst the rappers. That was it.
Right.
Just to be in the clique. Yeah. So now I've been in that, in the books, in the history books, and this, that, and the third. And if you name West Coast rappers, my name is going to, that's all I wanted. You know, I wanted to be in a movie. I've been in a few movies. I wanted to be on TV. So I wanted to write a book. I wrote a book. So I'm one of the few people that everything I've ever wanted to do, I've done.
Yeah.
You know, because I never set out to be the best.
Right.
That wasn't, I didn't set that goal.
To do it.
Right. I just wanted to do it. Me and Mickey wanted to do a good podcast and we're doing one.
Yeah.
So we wanted to do that movie, The Art of Rap.
We did it.
Produce.
We did
it. Your first one.
Yeah.
We did it.
We did it. So I'm very confident if it's something that I truly want to do, I'll complete it. We completed a new rock album. It may not be the biggest, but we did it. I'm into this.
It's one of the best. You know, like, the other thing I want
to
ask
is one of the best. Like you said, he just wants to complete it and say it's done. We don't say we want to ask to do something that we're
not
doing.
I would love it to happen,
right?
But I like to at least complete the mission.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm very proud of you, Ice. Yeah. I'm proud of what you've accomplished.
It's like
I do have your book at home. Mickey did give me your book. I do have your lick at home.
Yeah.
I have it sitting on top of my dresser, and I look at it all the time, and I it's an accomplishment of what you've done, and I'm very, very proud of what you've done.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, my thing is I try not to set out on roads that I'm not planning on finishing.
Yeah.
And, you know, I had me and Mickey being business partners for so many years. I told Mickey, I said, we just got to do less things because we finish what we set out to do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm not going to start something and then not finish it. So let's pick our roads a little bit more select. It's so easy. Do you understand? In a week, people, Ice, could you be part of this? Could you be part of that? Could you be part of this? Could you be part of that? We had to say no. Mickey is saying nah. Because we have things we're trying to do, and we have to focus on them to get those complete. And it's still a gang of shit.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's still a gang of shit. But I can't promise you that I'm going to be, you know, connected to your dream. You know, it's just, that's your dream.
Yeah, for sure.
That's your dream. So, philosophy, underpromise, an attempt to overproduce, and you'll always be looked at as a success. But if you overpromise and even win, but don't match that promise, you'll continue to be looked at as a failure. And that was philosophy. Hey, who's this? What you want to talk about?
Hey, my name's Christine. I'm from Boston. I'm a huge fan of the podcast. I love listening to all you guys talk about stuff. I'm also a huge SVU fan. And I'm calling to see if you have a favorite episode of SVU.
That's kind of hard because, you know, we're 350 episodes in.
Yeah, I know.
I actually had fun working with. I liked when Ludacris came on, you know, because he's one of my favorite rappers and a friend. It was fun to kind of, excuse me, work with him, you know, as a friend. I think I remember back when Carol Burnett came on the show. I think it's when I have people show up that I'm a fan of. You know what I'm saying? When Goldberg came on the show, I was a big fan of Goldberg. But I think that the beauty of SVU is the guest stars. Every time the guest stars come on, we just had Chad Coleman. I'm a big fan of Walking Dead, you know, and he was on.
Yeah, I'm excited for that.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? We had Megan Good. I mean, she was on the show. I'm a fan of hers, you know, gorgeous. She came on the show. So I think that's the gift of being on a show like Law & Order. The guest stars are always, you know, incredible. As far as an episode, no, I can't pick an episode.
That's fair. It's hard for me to pick my favorite episode as a fan.
Yeah. Well, thank you for being a fan of the show and the podcast. Tell your friends to listen to the podcast. We get raunchy at times, but you do get a little behind the scenes of SVU on here.
Thank you.
Take care.
This is Tony from Harlem.
Okay, what's cracking up in Harlem, man? What's going on? You on the podcast. What's happening?
Ain't nothing going on but gentrification up here, man. I didn't call about that, Ice.
Okay.
I love you, Ice, but I got to get into you right now, man. Okay. You got Leland Robinson on your podcast, right?
Yes, sir. He's right here.
I don't want to talk to him.
Uh-oh.
I want to say this. Now, you, Mickey, you're a street guy.
Yeah, I'm a street guy.
You know how many former rappers and old school rappers is working in Walmarts and Home Depots because of the Robinson family?
Nah, how can you blame it on the Robinson family?
For them giving out bad deals. They are the original Jimmy Iovine's Cash Money Records and P. Diddy's giving out bad record deals.
Okay, why don't we let... Since we got Leland here, I mean, you know, we street cats, right? You a street cat. You got to let the man speak.
Hey, Ice, you know me well. You know me well. And you know my family well. Okay? But let me tell you this. I wouldn't necessarily call myself a street cat, but my family's from the streets.
Okay.
Okay? And Mickey knows me, too.
Who are you?
Mickey used to know one of my artists, but that's
me right
there. My point is, the Robinson family used to give out bad record deals.
Who are you?
My name is Tony from Harlem, Ice.
Okay, Tony.
Okay, Tony from Harlem.
But you can't be like, you know us. And
right.
Like,
you know Tony from Harlem. I know 2,500 Tonys in Harlem.
Yeah, and Leland's here, so why don't you direct the question to Leland?
I'm just directed to you and Mick, because that's your podcast, and I'm trying to understand why you got the descendants of somebody who used to rape these artists on your podcast. That's the original question, right? That's all I wanted to know.
Let me ask you a question.
What's the point of having a question?
This is Leland. He wanted to
Let
talk
me ask you a question. Do you know it to be the truth or do you know it to be hearsay?
You really want to go there, Mr. Robinson?
Yeah, I really want to go there because what you're selling me is we the originals that are ripping people off. So I'm asking you, my question to you, my question to you is, you're going by hearsay, and I guarantee you any of those artists that you said that we ripped off or whoever we ripped off are still with us today. And that's what you don't know. And still doing business with us today. And still on tour with us today. So what are you talking about now?
Name the tour you have.
Any major artist that you said that was recorded with us that we robbed or we did something wrong to, they're still with us today. So what are you talking about?
You ever heard of Grandmaster Flash in the Trade Five?
Yes, Melly Mel is with us every day. And as a matter of fact, he's in Tennessee right now with us, with the rest of the group going on tour right now. So what are you saying? And he was the Melly Mel was the main writer for all the records. So what I'm saying to you is, tell me something new. Tell me something
Melly
that's not
Mel
the truth.
Don't have no choice to be with you right now. He has no more options. So stop. Don't bullshit him, Mr. Robinson.
Listen, everybody has no choices in life. It's how you make them.
You right now. Now, if you really want me to open the can of worms, I will. I was trying to be respectful to your dead mother.
No, you wasn't being respectful because you called up here and you said something to Mickey and you said, I don't want to talk to Leland.
I was directing the question to Mickey and Mr. Morrow because it's their podcast. I'm just saying, why on earth do they got Leland Robinson on this podcast? He adds nothing to it.
Okay, let me. All right, this is Mick talking. Let me tell you what it adds to the Ice-T Mick Benzo Final Level Podcast. It adds validity that Sugar Hill Records, the label itself, sir, created something that we were trying to do from the Boogie Down Bronx. We were doing mixtapes, they were called cassettes. His mom didn't do dub plates. She did records and got them on radio stations all over the nation. Not to say more is when you get into this business, none of us knew anything about the music industry. We were very excited to get a signed deal, whether it was $50,000, whether it was $100,000. It was money to us. One thing, as Melly Mel said in Rest in Peace at Miss Rob's funeral, there would be no Melly Mel if there wasn't a Sylvia Robinson. I'll just be a regular guy on the block called Melvin Glover.
I disagree with that. But I'll let you continue, Mick.
All right, I don't even know who you are. I got to go to the next caller. I don't know if you disagree with that.
At the end of the day...
The only thing the Robinsons did was exploit the kids from the Bronx. That's all they did.
Let me tell you something. This is Ice. And I'll tell you something. Most artists come out and they get record. Yes.
Hey, not to cut you off. And I'll tell you how close I am to this rap thing. And I don't want to name my uncle's name, okay? But I remember when you came to Forest Projects and you were from L.A. You came with, what's the girl that was on your album cover? Your former wife.
Okay, I came there.
We came to see Lord Finesse. Go ahead.
Right.
We know the area.
I remember, that's how far back I go with this thing, man. And my uncle, I remember the Robinsons gave my family 190 bins. Remember 190E's? White one? You remember that? You might be too young for that, Mr. Robinson. You remember when your family gave us 190
Evens? Gave us who? Who's your family?
They gave it to Mel, they gave it to Creole, they gave it to Rod, they gave it to Cowboy and Grandmaster Flash. They didn't, trying to figure out.
Okay, listen, Tony. All right, you on my podcast. Let me just break it down. This is what happens. When artists get in this business and it doesn't go the way they want and they fuck off their money and they do dumb shit and they get high and they do a lot of other unnecessary shit, Who do they blame it on? They blame it on the label. They say the label fucked us. They can't accept the fact that they made mistakes in their career. I've had it happen to me. I've had artists that I signed to Warner Brothers and got them big record deals and all of that. And at the end of the day, they say it was the label who fucked them. They can't man up and say we took the money and we squandered it, or we didn't handle our business the way we should have. I got the same record deal as everybody got on Sugar Hill Gang. I got the same fuck, the same way Warner Brothers fucked. Everybody gets fucked when you start in this business. The question is, are you smart enough to keep the money, or do you get mistaken and think you're a rock star and fuck the money off and then turn around and blame it on the label? So we're gonna say that a lot of this shit you're hearing about Sugar Hill Records is the artists not being honest with themselves and going out fucking their own money off, and we're gonna leave it at that. Leland's my friend, and that's why he's on the podcast. Peace.
Love you, Ice.
Peace.
And that's the truth.
You don't have to accept the deal that's being offered to you.
That's the truth. You
here we go. Listeners, we want you to understand. I'm glad this came up. We want you. You do not have to accept any deal that's being offered to you until you have it checked.
And when you actually start making records, you know, you're lucky if you get $1 a record. You're lucky if you get 50 cents a record. This is just the record business. But when an artist fails, I had an artist in my camp that we got him a record deal and everything went good and stuff. And then his record didn't sell. He blamed it on me. He said, well, how can I be in a label where only one person is making the money? I didn't get any money off of his record. I didn't produce his record. I didn't rap on his record. But he couldn't blame himself. Right. So he blamed it on the label. Yeah. And this is what it is. You know, but like Leland says, all these people still working with me. Why are they still working with me?
Exactly.
If I'm so terrible. Next caller.
Final Level Podcast. Who's this?
Who is this?
Hey, this is Dominic in Los Angeles.
Hey, Dom, what's cracking? What you want to talk about?
I just want to tell you guys, I was out a couple weeks ago in Mid-City going to see this band, and I'm at the venue. I see a flyer up on the wall that says Body Count gonna be playing at the venue. So I'm like, oh shit, that's fantastic. I saw you guys a couple years back in Greenpoint. It was an amazing show. So I'm like, I went to the show. Fuck, it was last night. So I just want to know if you guys are coming back to LA anytime soon, or if I just fucked up, missed my shot for a while.
Now we're gonna come back. Body Count is real strong right now. After the podcast, I'm actually going to do a video with a group called Upon a Burning Body, which I'm featured on. And then tomorrow we're doing the video for Institutionalized from the new Manslaughter album. So we're going. We actually booked a tour for Europe for the next summer. So Body Count is back, and we up, and we're not planning on going away. So we'll be back in LA. You know, it's just that working my schedule on the TV show, we're trying to keep all the balls in the air. I'm juggling, you feel me? But I'm glad you wanted to come see the show, and the show was incredible. You know, we were out there with, you know, a group called Trash Talk, Nomads. We had a good show. It was sold out, but we will be back in L.A., hopefully sooner versus later.
Yeah, I believe it, man. Last time I saw you guys was with No Redeeming Social Value at Club Europa in Greenpoint, maybe like 4 or 5 years ago.
Cool.
And that was amazing.
All right, well,
looking forward to seeing you guys again.
Stay tuned. Go to go to YouTube and check out Talk Shit Get Shot. That's our new video. We had almost 1 million views right now, so that's the business.
All right, check it out.
Thank you very much. Hey, this is Final Level Podcast 22. We got Leland Robinson in the house, Mick Benzo, and Alex, the man behind the podcast. Who's on the line?
Hey, what's up, IT? This is Chris.
Chris, where you at?
I'm calling from Arkansas.
Arkansas. Talk to me, baby. What's going on with you? What do you want to talk about?
All right, I just wanted to call up and let you know that I've been following your career for a while, back in 93. I'm sure you know the scene that was going on then, out in L.A. and even all over the U.S. Back in 93, I started in law enforcement, and I just wanted to give you a shout-out, you know, because you come out with the song Cop Killer, and you stuck by your guns and, you know, speaking up for yourself. And I had to tell Sam, you know, I had to go listen to the song and see what everything was about. So I went out and bought the album. And the album was being banned, so I had to get a few of them. You know, so I knew it was going to be a collector. But I, you know, I told all my law enforcement friends that, you know, you were coming from a different point of view. You were coming from a scene that was going on, something that we didn't have anything to do with in South Arkansas. And that it wasn't personal for every cop that was out there.
It was LAPD was out of control.
Yeah. And a lot of people around the U.S., I don't think they actually understood the scene that was going on out there. Because, you know, I had some relatives that live out there. But some of them took it personally, and I, you know, I stuck up for you, and I'm like, he's not talking to you. You're a good guy. You know, you don't have any problem. Just like, you know, if you're a criminal and we're checking somebody out, you ain't done nothing, you don't have a problem.
Absolutely.
That's not meant for them.
No, the record was about police brutality. That's what the record was about. And it was about a guy that I invented, not me, but a character who lost it and went on a binge after brutal cops. And, you know, are you still a police officer?
Yeah, I'm still a police officer.
Yeah, well, God bless you. You know, the thing of it is that, you know, you got to look at it from both sides of the fence, okay? I spent a lot of my time when I was in the streets breaking the law, all right? How can I be mad at a cop? I mean, I'm breaking the law. You dig what I'm saying? So you can't be mad. And I tell people every day, I say cops are human beings. They're human beings. And some of them have the greatest intentions in the world, man, just to try to make the world safe. Then some of them, they have their own agendas. Right or wrong?
Yeah, that's right.
That's right or wrong.
I used to tell everybody, if you ain't doing nothing bad out here, you're not mistreating anybody, you're not getting crooked, you know, using your job for crooked, you don't have anything to worry about. He's not talking to you.
Yeah.
But a couple of other songs after I'm listening to the album, you know, like KKK Bitch and Evil Dick, I was listening to that stuff, and I'm like, man, that's what the album got banned. It's not even that other song.
You know, Mama's got
a strong album. I'm a guitar player and I'm a rock and roll guy. So, you know, that was right down my alley. A lot of metal. And the new album, it's slamming.
Thank you. You listen to
Mom. Down in the middle of Pop Bubble.
Yeah. Yeah. And Mama's Gotta That's Die tonight. I killed my own mother because she was a racist. You know?
Yeah.
So, you know what? But I respect you to the fullest. You know, I tell people, I said, you know, there was a part of my life, like I said, when I was breaking the law. Of course, I wasn't fond of the cops. But now I've come across good cops, bad. You guys are human beings. And you just never know. It's the luck of the draw. You know, any cop out there that says every cop is an angel, he knows he's lying. He knows there's bad cops and good cops. So thank you for calling in. And I'm glad you like the new Manslaughter album. You know, rock on, homie.
Arkansas.
All right,
keep up the good work.
I appreciate that love. You take care, officer. Peace. Let's do one more because I got to go. All y'all know I'm out here right now. I'm about to go do a video. And we're going to get out of there. So this will be the last call today. Who's this?
What's up, Ice? This is Constantine Rain calling from Berlin, Germany. What's up, man?
Oh, shit. See? World Wide Web. Berlin, Germany. What's cracking?
Worldwide, Ice. I'm chilling. I'm in the mall right now. And I got a tweet saying that, you know, you put that number out there. But I'm trying to find a little corner here where I can't get distracted by all the background noise. I hope you can hear me.
I hear you, but you're in Germany, so you get a pass.
Thanks, man. Thanks. Well, last time you came to Germany, I don't know if you remember this, you probably do, but I watched your show at a summer festival when you came through with Hijack back in 1990.
Wow.
Might have been 91 at a summer festival. It was you, Hijack, DJ Aladdin. It was like a whole bunch of cats at the dog room. I was out there on the stage with a mink coat. Remember that?
I remember we came through. We brought everybody. Hijack from Great Britain. You know, I used to always take all the syndicate groups out to try to help them jump off back in the day. So, yes, I remember.
What's your relationship with Divine Steiner now? Because I saw him. He has a Twitter account, and he's making different music now. He's making more of an experimental hip-hop fusion type. I'm not sure what to call it, but you have any contact with Divine Steiner?
Nah, you know, I met Divine through a guy named DJ Bilal. Bilal was a producer. He produced records for me like Take It Personal, and he also was the one who introduced me to Everlast. He also was connected to a rapper named Def Jeff. So that was Bilal's little clique. And when I met Divine, I'm like, you're unique. I'm into different shit. I'm not into every, you know, if you rap like everybody else, I'm like not impressed. So I always was into people that was different. But Divine was always unique. So I've seen a few tweets about Divine, and I saw him on a, I think that on Twitter they got Hip Hop Golden Age and they showed his record and stuff. But me and Divine always have been cool. I would love to see Divine again, but I haven't seen him in years. But he's definitely on another channel, so to speak. But a good one. A good one and a needed one. I mean, he got
it.
Oh, he got a record called Tongue of Labyrinth. I don't know what the fuck he's talking about, but it's dope.
Hey, let me ask you, why you always giving Mickey a hard time, man? I mean, I really enjoyed that episode you and Mickey did alone when Mickey got deep into the history of hip-hop with New York and stuff. And I also appreciate you have Leah on right now. I don't know what the other guy was talking about, that chap from Harlem. Could have been anybody. I was like, man, I hope I'm not next because that's going to be hard to follow.
Now,
I really appreciate that episode you had with Mickey, where Mickey got deep into the history of him and Bombada and the whole crew. And,
you know what it is? I'm going to tell you. I'll tell you what it is. You know, when we got, if we doing a real live podcast, if somebody call up and they got beef, we going to let the beef be expressed, you know. But when you call up and you don't want to give up your name or who you are, and that's suspect right out the gate, you dig?
And his cousins. Everybody's his cousin.
Everybody's his cousin.
My cousin, and my cousin did this. My cousin bought a 190. My cousin this.
Yeah, and you got the man right here. But you don't want to talk to him. That, you know, we regulated that guy. But at the end of the day, man, you know, Mickey and me are friends, and we like brothers, and we've been together so long that's how homies do. We just talk shit to each other. You know, it's all love. People think I'm beating Mickey. Nobody can beat Mickey down. Let's just get something straight. Mickey ain't no punk. Mickey, you know, but he lets me fuck with him. I wouldn't advise you to try to fuck with Mickey the way I speak on him, man.
Nah, that's that love that we got, man. After 30 years of being together, we able to feed off each other. And sometimes you want to hear how I wanted you to hear how Ice would really react if someone was saying any dumb shit. So I'll do the dumb shit and let him show you that even he treats his friends. If you're saying something fucked up, it ain't 20 grand around here, nigga. You fucked up. That's not the right word. You're not doing it right. But no, it's all in fun. And we appreciate you calling all the way from Germany and exposing that and caring about what we're doing. That's love. That's love.
Hey, no doubt. No,
yeah, mix of OG Zulu. I can't fuck with that.
I want to make to Alex. Alex, good job on the podcast. Mr. Robinson, you're a legend. You paved the way for many artists.
Thank you, sir.
With the whole culture, the genre has is sitting on your back, really. And Mickey, for you, you know, Hopkins is fighting tonight, man. Hopkins is just, you know, he's getting up there in age, but still running the game like you brothers. Who's going to win the fight? Hopkins or Corrales?
Bernard's coming back, man. 50-something years old, he's going to do his goddamn thing. You watch Mr. BH do what he do best.
You think so?
Yeah, I know so.
I know I can bust 98% of these young niggas' asses.
Watch
I'm old.
What he do?
I know.
Watch what he do.
Come on. You want to bet on Bernard?
Yes, I would.
You going to bet on Bernard?
I would. Lily, yes, I would.
Put me in the ring with one of these little 20-year-old tight pants wearing rappers. Bet on Ice. I'm busting their ass. I'll fight five of them in one night.
My money's on Ice-T.
I'm knocking niggas out. I'm still benching 300. I'm good, nigga. Don't worry about me. Hey, yo, homie, take care, man. Thanks for calling from Germany.
Thank you for having me on, Ice. You're a legend, brother. I love you.
Peace. Love you, too. Hey, and there it was, Leland. That's what we do. We do this twice a week.
I love it. Yeah. I even like the controversy. Nothing bothers me, Ice. You know what I'm saying? Nothing bothers me. I like it. I like the feedback and forth and get these guys aggravated.
Because they have no grounds.
They have no ground.
Niggas,
I love it.
Like you say, when you come with your contrary, is this based on fact or is this based on hearsay? Sir. You know, and like the cats, even people got beef with me for whatever reason, you know, this, but it's very rare they're gonna say it to my face. Right. Usually when they say it, they don't have any grounds. They heard something, I said something, this, that, and the third. You know, because I don't live a foul life.
That's right.
You don't live a foul life. Mick don't live a foul life. We don't do that.
No.
You don't do that. So your grounds is bullshit. Whatever you heard, or Ice ripped this person off.
I mean, I think you said it best too, though, Ice. You said when you signed a Sire record contract for Warner Brothers, you didn't get the deal you wanted. You didn't get, you know, all of your publishing.
But see, I won. Right. I managed it correctly, so exactly. Therefore,
you didn't,
I ain't mad at the label.
You didn't sit back and complain and didn't do nothing about it. You went out and branched off and did other things and then decided to get you a deal so you can help others. And like you said, you helped them out. And then they said, well, Ice could have gave me more money. Well, then you should have asked for more money and I'll see if it's something I can afford to do.
Or you should have got your own record deal.
Or if you can accept what I'm giving you, if you accept what I'm
reality,
giving you,
Ice.
If you accept what I'm giving you, don't come back later talking about what I should have given you. That's not how the business goes.
Well, one thing I could say, Mickey, is I could walk down the street with a clear mind. I didn't do nothing to nobody. You know what I mean? That's one thing. That's first thing is first. And then the problem is out here is you ask a person, yo, I don't like that dude, Mickey. Why you don't like him? Mm-hmm. I don't know. People don't even know why they don't like you. Mm-hmm. They just say they don't like you because it's you. Not that you ever did anything to this person. Right. They just don't like you because it's you.
Yeah, you want me to give you a hit you with some philosophy again one more time? The last person you blame for your problems usually is yourself.
Absolutely. Yeah.
That's why they have a mirror.
And it needs to be the first person you blame. We always can find 100 reasons why shit fucked up, but guess what? Probably was me. And I always tell people, everybody's in the position they are because of their actions. You're where you are because of your actions. If you want to change your position, you have to change your actions. You keep using the same recipe, you're going to keep baking the same cake.
Yep. Absolutely.
You dig? So, you know, we all know, Mick, we've had our ups, we've had our falls, but then we like, you know what? I might have played that wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, let me get my shit together. So when I hear people bitching and shit, I'm like, you know what? You know, you left out the part while you were smoking crack. You left that part out.
Yeah.
Yep. You left that part out. That's the problem.
Right. So, or even just the fact that, like, if you're running a label, people are bound to dislike you. Like, people just don't understand what it's like to run a label or be in those shoes. I have no idea, but I just know from running a business on my
end. Losers always have a problem with the team.
You'll have the same problem, Alex, because your show is going to be big with a lot of the different people, but the people that it's not big with, they're going to say that you
did it. It was
your fault.
Right. Absolutely. You made the mistake.
You made the mistake, and Alex, you didn't do what you did for Ice-T. You didn't do what you did for this one or RuPaul. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So bottom line is they're going to blame you because you're the head in charge.
Yeah, and I learned so much stuff. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
Yeah, go ahead, baby.
I learned so much stuff. Like, when I started this company, I was kind of a punk rocker. I was like, fuck all these people, and they're not doing shit the way I like, and, you know, they're screwing artists and this and that. And then you go into it, and you can do what you can to the best of your abilities, but when you see the other end for the first time, you're like, oh, shit, this is actually a business where when you're a record label, you have one dude who pays for everybody else, and then he has to get a gold record before you see anything. And it's hard.
Business is hard. Like I was just saying, my wife, she has a clothing line business. She got it on the internet. She's been doing it. She's working. She's busting her ass. She looks at her numbers. She broke even. All the money she made, she reinvested back into her website and stuff like that. She said, I ain't make no money. I said, well, look at it this way. You don't have to pay any taxes. But you're building a brand, and this is the business. And it's hard when you have overhead and all these things. So it's easy to blame it on the label. It's all that. You know, if you start winning, you just don't blame as many people because you're just winning. You're winning. You're praising people. But thanks for being on the show.
Glad to be here, Ice.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know, at the end of the day, sometimes you gotta open that can of worms because that's, you know, people might be thinking that, but this is what it is.
Exactly.
So, you know, we will never sabotage a motherfucker on the show. But Leland, I mean, you stood your ground and fuck him. You dig what I'm saying?
That's what I say.
Sugar Hill was the reason I started rapping because when I saw that record label, I said, man, this is some new shit I want to learn how to do. Mick Benzo, it's always wonderful having you here, Mickey.
Hey, man, I can't do it without you, though, Ice. And yeah. Alex, thank you for making this happen for real, B.
Dude, and thank.
I'm so tired from this anniversary though, man. That's why my voice is a little, you know, shaking.
And in closing, we always say to everybody, if you are a fan of the Final Level Podcast, turn somebody else on to the podcast world. This is the future. And most of you guys have never listened to a podcast till you start to listen to us. So the only thing we'd like you to do is turn them on to podcasts. Podcasts are hip. Music is sucking right now on the radio. They're only playing 20 records over and over again. You might get a little information that might change your life or at least entertain you and give you a good laugh. We love y'all. Peace, and as Ice-T always says, I'm out of here like I stole something.
See ya!
That's how I'm living.